Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and also I invite Fellowship of Ministerial Assistant FMA to this sessions on Old Testament, New Testament, and brothers also and counseling.
Christ, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and also I invite
for the glory of God.
FMA to
let us join in singing, Jesus, keep me near the cross.
Old Testament, New Testament, and also counseling.
Christ, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and also I invite Almighty and everlasting Father, we come to a throne of grace with deep gratitude and thanks. Lord, once again, you fill us with your spirit. Season of Pentecost, be reasonable and fruit-bearing. Lord, we commit all the viewers, the participants, and those who are watching into your mighty hand. Reveal your mysteries of this great book, Bible. Lord, once again, we commit all of us into your hand. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are today dealing with four papers which are going to be on. The first session will be on history of Israel. The second will be on the New Testament, introduction to New Testament. And third is counseling, family counseling by Reverend Job Jairaj. And again, fourth will be introduction to Book of Genesis. That will be the last session. And I request you to send your clarification if at all you want to clarify few things of today's presentations. I request you to send in between times to our online network. So the history of Israel is one of the main themes of world history, because this history is written in the book Biblos, a book called Bible. As we have seen, the Old Testament and the New Testament was written in its own time with various authors, editors, compilers, and also readers and people who reflected on Bible. And today we are going to see some of the historical evidences as well as historical reference to Bible, and that is called the history of Israel. So normally biblical narratives are historical, religious, and also it is theological. But the recent excavation, that is the last century excavations, have proved that archaeological excavations and research on Bible and Bible events are becoming very evident. Earlier it was very difficult for people to understand the historical significance or the relevance of Bible events, but now after going through some of the major excavations in Holy Land and also other parts of the old biblical land, the things are coming very clear. For example, Hittites were one community or one group of people who were very powerful, and they were very ancient civilization, and their information was found in the last century, that was in 1906, in a place called Bogoski in Turkey. Excavations were done there, and then people found a lot of information on Hittites, and this brought major information of the people of Sumeria, the Babylon, and other cultures, and thereby this excavation was very historical, and they are very important for today's reflection, whether it is archaeological evidence or historical evidence. Therefore, it is very important to see that some of the excavations are very fruitful in understanding Bible history. And now we'll go to age of patriarch. Patriarch simply means fathers, great fathers of the nation called Israel. And the very moment we think of patriarchs, the first name comes to our mind is Abraham. Therefore, before Abraham, the Bible also talks about the prehistory of the world, the creation, the fall, the giants who lived during the flood, and also that Noah's Ark and the Tower of Babel and things like that. So up to 11 chapters you have this creation story and related story belonging to human fall and other major crises, major issues in the human formation. Therefore, the age of patriarch is very, very crucial, because it takes God's redemption act in promises. Therefore, God promises Abraham a great nation, a great people, a faithful community. Therefore, formerly this history of patriarchs was theological, and this formation was very theological in understanding, religious, and it is faith oriented. But today, the study and the archaeology has also proved that history of patriarchs in this historical events are similar, or records are there in other historical narrations of other histories of the time. Therefore, though no more they are mythological or mythical, but they are all geographical in nature and also proved historically during that time. Maybe time and location of time differs, but major events and major historical references are very clear that there was a history of patriarchs, particularly Abraham. The word Abraham comes from the word Ibir. Ibir means a vagabond, a one who travels from place to place. ಒಬ್ಬ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿ ಒಂದು ಸ್ಥಳದಿಂದ ಮತ್ತೊಂದು ಸ್ಥಳಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗುವಂಥವರನ್ನು ಇಬಿರ್ ಅಂತ ಇಬ್ರಿಯ ಭಾಷೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಕರೀತಾರೆ. ಅದು ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮ ಆಗಿ ಅದು ಮುಂದುವರೆದಿದೆ. ಅದು ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮ ಎಂಬುದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಈ ಜನಾಂಗದ ಹೆಸರೇನಿದೆ, ಇದು ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮನ ಮೂಲ ಪುರುಷನಾದಂಥ ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮನಿಗೆ ಅದು ಬಂದಿದೆ. ಇವನು ಊರ್ ದೇಶದಿಂದ ಬಂದರು. ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಎ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಊರ್ ಇನ್ ಮೆಸೊಪಟೋಮಿಯಾ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ರೆಫರೆನ್ಸಸ್ ಟು ದ ನೇಮ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್. And the places like Nuzi, Haran, Padam Haran, and also the language, culture of Babylonia, it closely relates to patriarchs and their vision of God and their understanding of God and their traditions and also their worship and also their religious beliefs. Therefore, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ನೋಡುವಂಥ ವಿಷಯ ಏನಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ನೂಜಿ ಅಂತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು, ಹರಾನ್ ಅಂತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು, ಪದಂ ಹರಾನ್ ಅಂತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು, ಇವೆಲ್ಲವೂ ಸಹ ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮನ ಕಾಲದ ಪಿತೃಗಳಿಗೆ ಸಂಬಂಧಪಟ್ಟಂಥ ಸ್ಥಳಗಳಾಗಿರೋದರಿಂದ ಇವುಗಳಿಗೆ ಚಾರಿತ್ರಿಕವಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಈ ದಿವಸದ ಪುರಾವೆಗಳಿದೆ. ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಎವಿಡೆನ್ಸ್, ಹಿಸ್ಟಾರಿಕಲ್ ಎವಿಡೆನ್ಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಟು ಪ್ರೂವ್ ದಟ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದಿಸ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ಕಲ್ಟಿವೇಟೆಡ್ ದ ರಿಲಿಜಿಯಸ್ ಬಿಲೀಫ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಥಿಯೋಲಾಜಿಕಲ್ ಬಿಲೀಫ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದೋಸ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸಸ್. ಇದು ಇವರ ಕಾಲ ನಾವು ನೋಡುವಾಗ ಇದು 1792 ಬಿ ಸಿ, ಅಂದರೆ ಸುಮಾರು 18 ಶತಮಾನಗಳು ಹಿಂಭಾಗದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಹೋಗಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಪ್ಯಾಟ್ರಿಯಾಕ್ಸ್ ಲೀವ್ಡ್ ಅರೌಂಡ್ 1792 to 1750 ಬಿ ಸಿ, ದಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮ್ಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅರೌಂಡ್ 2000 ಬಿ ಸಿ ಈಸ್ ಅ ಟೈಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೈಗ್ರೇಷನ್. ಸುಮಾರು 2000 ಕ್ರಿಸ್ತಪೂರ್ವದಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಜನರು ಊರ್ ದೇಶದಿಂದ ಅಥವಾ ಮೆಸೊಪಟೋಮಿಯಾ ಅಥವಾ ಈ ಜಾಗದ ಊರುಗಳಿಂದ ಅವರು ವಾಗ್ದತ್ತ ದೇಶದ ಕಡೆಗೆ ಹೊರಟರು ಎಂಬುದಾಗಿ ನಾವು ಸತ್ಯವೇದದಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾಣ್ತೇವೆ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮನು ಸಹ ಅವರೊಂದಿಗೆ ಪ್ರಯಾಣ ಮಾಡಿ ಬರುವುದನ್ನು ಕಾಣುತ್ತೆ. ಪದಂಬರ ಅಂತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಒಂದು ಜಾಗ, ಅಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಮತ್ತೆ ಆತನು ಇಸ್ರೇಲ್ ಅಥವಾ ಈ ದಿನ ಪ್ಯಾಲೆಸ್ಟೀನ್ದ ದೇಶ ಏನಿದೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಆತನು ಕಾರವಾನ್ ಮೂಲಕವಾಗಿ ಆಗಮಿಸುತ್ತಾನೆ ಎಂಬುದಾಗಿ ನಾವು ಅದನ್ನು ಕಾಣ್ತೇವೆ. ಮತ್ತು ಈಜಿಪ್ಟ್ ಮತ್ತು ಇಸ್ರೇಲ್ಗಿರುವಂಥ ಸಂಬಂಧ, ಇದು ಚಾರಿತ್ರಿಕವಾಗಿ ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಜಾಗ. ವಿ ನೀಡ್ ಟು ಅಂಡರ್ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ದ ರಿಲೇಷನ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಈಜಿಪ್ಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇಸ್ರೇಲ್. ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಟೈಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಹಿಕ್ಸಸ್. ಹಿಕ್ಸಸ್ ಎನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ವಂಶದ ಕಾಲ ಐಗುಪ್ತದಲ್ಲಿರುವಾಗ, ಅದರ ಕಾಲ 1786 ಬಿ ಸಿ 1552 ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಕ್ರೈಸ್ಟ್, ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ 1786 ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ 1552. ದೇರ್ ವಾಸ್ ಎ ಡೈನಾಸ್ಟಿ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಹಿಕ್ಸಾಸ್. ದೇ ವರ್ ದ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಹೂ ಟುಕ್ ದ ಹೋಲ್ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಬಿಲ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್. ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಎ ಮಿಕ್ಸೆಡ್ ಏಷ್ಯಾಟಿಕ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಯುನೋ ಕ್ಲ್ಯಾನ್ ವಿಚ್ ವಾಸ್ ದೇರ್ ವೆರಿ ಪವರ್ಫುಲ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಟೈಮ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ವರ್ ದ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಹೂ ಹವ್ ನಾಟ್ ಸೀನ್ ಜೋಸೆಫ್. ಯೋಸೆಫನನ್ನು ಅರಿಯದಂತೆ ಇರುವಂಥ ಅಂಥೇಳಿ ಸತ್ಯವೇದದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಕಾಣ್ತೇವೆ. ಆ ಒಂದು ಜನಾಂಗ ಯಾವುದಂದರೆ ಹಿಕ್ಸಾಸ್. ಅವರು ಭಾಳ ಪ್ರಭಾವಿತವಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಜನಾಂಗ, ಯುದ್ಧದಲ್ಲಿ ಇರುವಂಥ ಜನಾಂಗ. ಇವರನ್ನು ಇಂಡೋ ಆರಿಯನ್ಸ್ ಎಂಬುದಾಗಿ ಸಹ ಕರೀತಾರೆ. ದೇ ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಮಿಕ್ಸ್ಡ್ ರೇಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡೋ ಆರಿಯನ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ವರ್ ಸೆಮಿಟಿಕ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ವರ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಸೆಮಿಟಿಕ್ಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ರೋಸ್ ಟು ಪವರ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಹಿಕ್ಸಾಸ್. ಈ ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಹಿಕ್ಸಾಸ್ ವಂಶಾವಳಿಯ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಯೋಸೆಫನು ರಾಜ್ಯವನ್ನು ಅಥವಾ ದೇಶವನ್ನು ಅಧೀನಕ್ಕೆ ತೆಗೆದುಕೊಳ್ಳುತ್ತಾನೆ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಸುಮಾರು ಒಂದು 460 ವರ್ಷಗಳ ಕಾಲದ ಈ ಚರಿತ್ರೆ, ಅರೌಂಡ್ 460 ಇಯರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಸ್ರೇಲ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಈಜಿಪ್ಟ್ ಬ್ರಿಂಗ್ಸ್ 460 ಇಯರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಪ್ರೆಷನ್. ದೇರ್ಫೋರ್ ದ ಎಕ್ಸಡಸ್ ಬಿಗಿನ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದಟ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಆನ್ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್. ಸೊ the new king of that time was known to Moses but not to Joseph. That was the condition. Exodus 1:8, we can see that very clearly in that. Who was identified with second Ramses? He was the king during the time of the plagues, and also during the time of Exodus, the real Exodus, Passover and other Exodus events. That was during 1290 and 1224. That is the estimated time of Exodus period. And this man, this great Ramses II, he forced Israelite to build Pitrom and also Ramses. They are the big cities, and they were also granaries, and also they started building infrastructure to this new kingdom. This Hyksos were very powerful people. At the same time, politically, outside, they are very weak. This is the condition before the Exodus. From north also, from north means the land of Palestine and also Syria and other places, and Aegean Sea, that is around Turkey and other places. Egyptians, pharaohs were very strong earlier, but during the time of Exodus, the Egyptian kings were very weak, pharaohs were very weak, and there used to be many attacks from the north, from the even from Palestinian then Canaan kings are also attacking the northern part of Egypt. Therefore, it was very weak position for pharaohs, and there were also heterogeneous people, not just one, two people, around two, three communities were attacking these people, but around Egypt, many nations were also taking wars against Egypt or pharaohs. Therefore, Exodus story comes in a time where the pharaoh was very weak. Though they were building big, big programs in their capital, but the land was very weak according to the historical evidences. Therefore, around 460 years earlier was not a possible condition to the time of Exodus. Time of Exodus was very weak for politically for pharaohs. And therefore, second Ramses, and also Israel's were, during that time, the second Ramses was having a opinion that there used to be earlier settlement of Israel in Palestine. That means he was realizing that people were already there, the Israelites were already there in Palestine. So that was his opinion according to historical historical facts. And therefore, the freedom or the Exodus has taken during 1230 BC. This is the time, people are thinking about the Exodus time. And now, settlement in Canaan. So the Exodus takes place, the plagues were on, and then the people crossed the Red Sea, and they moved to the promised land under the leadership of Joshua and Moses, death of Moses, or God takes Moses to his time, and then Joshua leads, and the Gideon and other people start ruling the people of Israel. Now, the settlement in Canaan, according to Amarna letter, that was in 1375 and 1300, Egypt seems to have lost total control over Canaan around this time. What we see is already Egypt was weak, and now during the time of Exodus also, Egypt was not strong. They were not able to even capture the runaway slaves or the Moses and the people, and there was a large number of slaves taken Exodus in that time. It is something like today's Exodus, you know, migrant workers are moving from one place to another. So similar to that, this Exodus also gives a clue that people, the workers, the migrant workers, they travel from one place to another in search of their life. Therefore, similar to that, not only Israel and many nations, many slave groups in Egypt were also came out of this bondage, and they joined this great Exodus of more than 10 lakh. So this is exactly the problem. And in Canaan, in Canaan or in the people in the land of Palestine, there were other dominant groups like Edomites were there, Moabites were there, Amorites were there, and these people were also very strong, and they were giving opposition to Pharaoh from time to time. Therefore, for Egypt, it was not very easy task to attack these people again, because they keep quiet. After the Exodus, there is no connection between Israel and also Egypt. For a long time, there is going to be an isolation from these people. And from time to time, people of Israel remember Egypt, remember their food, remember their past. Whenever they face death and whenever they face crisis, they immediately refer to Egypt, because their slavery was a long time, that is 460 years. Therefore, they were remembering Egypt. But Egypt was not a place for them to remember according to God's plan. And therefore, these Edomites, Moabites, and Amorites, and some of these people were living in this kind of places, and this is called Transjordan area, the Transjordan area that was in 13 BC. That is the time this whole nation was surrounded by all these people. Therefore, for Joshua, it is very difficult for him to take over the land. The settlement of Canaan was not that easy, and it was a very slow process, and it took a long time. It is not an immediate takeover from these people, because Israel were also afraid of the people who are living in that land during the time of Jericho and also other falls. Joshua always reminds them that you should go and see what is there in the land. How is your people? How are the enemies? How strong they are? Therefore, these people who are living in the Canaan or the place called Transjordan, and they were militarily very strong people, and they had horses and chariots for they were using in the land. And they were also part of other nations, their politics, their warfare, and their religion. Therefore, this is a compilation of so many forces, religious forces, military forces, and also the social forces, cultural forces, which made Joshua and people to very difficult to understand the people of that land. Archaeologically, it proved that the settlement to some extent was a guerrilla warfare. They went there with Joshua, and they occupied some of the lands, and also there was warfare here and there, and these warfares were not peaceful. Later on, they became peaceful, but earlier these wars are very ferocious wars, and people fought for their survival. And also, the southern area called Judah in Negev, this is the southern part immediately after Egyptian border, the small warfare used to take place. And these kind of wars were led by Ephraim and also Benjaminites. These are the tribes which are very powerful. Later on, we see that during the time of Samuel, Benjamin tribe, Saul becomes the first king. Therefore, their history of military warfare was very strong, even from from the time they landed in Promised Land. And crossed before crossing Jordan and after crossing Jordan also, they were the tribes who took military leadership. And during the time of Joshua and also later on with other judges and later on kings also. And House of Joseph was also called to take force to settling some of the towns and cities during the time of Joshua. That also we see. And much of the land remains to be subdued. This is a word we find in Joshua 13, 1 to 5. Much of the land. Innu aneka jagagalanna avaru akramisabeku, avaru adanna tegidukollabeku ennuvanta devara ondu uddeshavanna naavu Yehoshuvana grantha 13ne adhyaya 1-rinda 5 vakyagalannu naavu nodutteva. Ad karana Yehoshuvana kaalada yuddhagalinde adu ondu reetiyalli naavu nodvaga adu military yuddhagalu, andre yuddha maaduvantadu, katti ivugalannu hidudu yuddha maadi jagagalannu avaru akramisuvantadu. Mattondu kade naavu nodvaga Israeli mukhyavagi Benjamin ಗೋತ್ರದ ಯೋಸೆಫನ ಗೋತ್ರದ ಇಫ್ರಾಹಿಂ ಗೋತ್ರದ ಕೆಲ ಜನರು ಈ ನಾಯಕತ್ವವನ್ನು ವಹಿಸ್ತಾರೆ. ಆ ಕಾರಣದಿಂದಾಗಿ ದಾವಿದನ ಮುಂಚಿನ ಒಬ್ಬ ರಾಜನ ನಾವು ನೋಡುವಾಗ ಅವನು ಬೆಂಜಮಿನ್ ಕುಲದಿಂದ ಬಂದಂಥವನು, ಅವನ ಹೆಸರು ಸಾಲ್ ಎಂಬುದಾಗಿ ನಾವು ನೋಡುತ್ತೇವೆ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಈ ಮುಂದಿನ ಚರಿತ್ರೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ವಿಚಾರವನ್ನು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ತೇವೆ. ದ ಫರ್ದರ್ ದ ಹಿಸ್ಟೋರಿಯನ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಓಲ್ಡ್ ಟೆಸ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಹಿಸ್ಟೋರಿಯನ್ಸ್ ದಿ ಒನ್ ಮಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಜಾರ್ಜ್ ಮೆಂಡೆಲ್ ಹಾಲ್, ಹೀ ಈಸ್ ಒನ್ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ನಾರ್ಮನ್ ಗುಟ್ವಾಲ್ಡ್, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ಪ್ರಪೋಸ್ ದ ಥಿಯರಿ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಸಾರಿ ಪೆಸೆಂಟ್ ರಿವೋಲ್ಟ್ ಅಗೇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಕ್ಯಾನನೈಟ್ಸ್. ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅ ವಾರ್ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ, ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಎ ರೆಬಿಲಿಯನ್ ಆರ್ ದ ರೆವಲ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಿಚುವೇಶನ್ ಅಕಾರ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಜಾರ್ಜ್ ಮೆಂಡೆಲ್ ಹಾಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ನಾರ್ಮನ್ ಗುಟ್ವಾಲ್ಡ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ಸೇ ದಿಸ್ ವಾಸ್ ಅ ಪೆಸೆಂಟ್ ವಾರ್. This is not a military war, but it's a peasant war, because peasants were already there in the land of Canaan. And they saw this new coming of Israel to the Canaan. They were also used as the peasants in that land. And there was discrimination between the Canaanites and also Israelites. Therefore, the hypothesis is they would have created some kind of, you know, differences between these two peasant groups. Therefore, there was a revolt against Canaanites or the Palestinians by the Israeli and other people who settled initially in Palestine. And Martin North, another professor, he proposes the Amphitainu, that means tribes taking over their religious altars. This is one of the argument put by Martin North, and according to him, tribes controlled the existing Canaanite places of worship and other sacrifices, and this is there in other civilizations also. For example, in island of Delos in Greece, and such practices were there. Once somebody takes your religious position, once they take your religious altars, religious centers, and they win the war, and they are the people who will take over your other life situations also. They come under the one who takes over the religious positions of such people. Therefore, it's a religious defeat as well as a social and political defeat of the people. Therefore, that was also, that kind of things were also there. For example, some of the altars in Old Testament, for example, Mamre and or Bethel and some of these Hebron and some of these religious places were also part of the war, and they used to be destroyed. For example, Jerusalem, many times Jerusalem temple was destroyed because it's a religious place. Once somebody takes religious control over that, or political control over that religious center, and they become part of their defeat. Therefore, this was also taking place during that time, and name Yahweh was very strong from the Israeli side, and therefore such songs are also sung during the occupation. For example, Song of Deborah, you find that in Judges and also in other places. And reports were also given on this kind of stories. And even Song of Mary also talks about this kind of victory over other people by Lord Yahweh. Therefore, now we come to the time of Judges. Judges are called Shaptim in Hebrew. The word Shaptim means Hebrew word judge. Judge means the understanding of judge during the time of Israeli occupation was they were also military leaders. Judges were not just sitting someplace and then giving directions, but they're also part of leading the military troops to win wars. And it was purely a theocracy. Theocracy means God's rule. Theocracy means God's rule. God's rule was taken very seriously by the people called judges in the book of Judges. And 4 to 8 talks about this kind of judges. were also very evident during this time. Their tribe, they used to represent the tribes. Each tribe had a judge, and he will be the military ruler, or he is the leader of the community. He is responsible for all whatever happens within the community. Therefore, judges were having more responsibility than any other person in the community. Therefore, judges were ruling the people of Israel. That's what we call theocracy, God's rule. The judges, and they are righteous people, and also they are very strong and prayerful people, leading people to victory over victory during this time. And we have judges of two kinds, smaller leaders and also bigger leaders. For example, judges refer to six main judges. Othniel is one, book of Judges 3, 7 to 11 you find, and also Yehud is also one judge, and Shamgar, judges also refers 5:31, and Barak and Deborah, they are also judges. The woman judge was also there, and Gideon again, he is a major judge during this time, and Jephthah, and he sacrifices his own daughter. He's a very committed person to God, and he declares that if I win the war, or after the war, if God gives me victory, if I walk to my house, if somebody comes from my house, whichever it is, animal or human beings, anybody, I will sacrifice, he says. That was the vow made to God. According to that, he wins the war, and when he comes to house, and he will see his daughter coming out, so he sacrifices his daughter. That kind of committed judges were also there. And finally, you have a person called Samson. Samson's story we know, he's a legend, and this legend story ends up in a tragedy, because he was not serious about God's promises and also covenant. Therefore, the rule of judges comes to an end with Samson, and you have also minor judges in that time. Again, Tola is one judge, and Jair is another judge, and Ibzan, Elon, and Abaddon, and these are some of the smaller judges. If you read carefully the book of Judges, you find all these smaller judges also. Therefore, God was not making people to be free during this crisis time. After Joshua, Gideon takes the takeover, will be done by other military rulers, and also Abimelech and other story also shows that there was a conflict between God's choice of good leaders, good judges, and good military forces against people electing their own king, because they were conditioned by the people around them, who are all non-Israelites, non-Israel. These people had their own kings, their own capitals, their own states, small groups, small territories, and they were led by kings. The military warfare was done by the leaders, who are also kings. Therefore, they thought that king will be ideal for them to understand the war. They thought, people of Israel thought, it is not judges, but the kings. If you anoint king, if you select a king, king will take over people's life seriously. That was the understanding of Israel. Whereas God's understanding is different. God's understanding is theocracy, not monarchy, not under the rule of human leadership. He says theocracy, or God's rule, is more important. That's the understanding of God, and there is a difference of opinion. And finally, I think God allows to go for king, and that is where you have the first king coming through Saul. And Saul and monarchy begins. Monarchy was also a necessity to lead war against the Philistines. As I told you earlier, Philistines were very, very strong people. They're stronger than Israel. They're stronger than Israel and other nations also. They were actually challenging the pharaohs. Therefore, the battles were very furious, very intense. And therefore, they wanted a great leader for them to win the war. Therefore, king was also a necessity at the time, according to people, and then they were also called to take a war against them. And Nephilims were one of the characters of the Philistines. Philistines were very big in size. They're called giants. And therefore, in Book of Joshua also, you see that Israeli the troops or the people were afraid of this Palestinians, because they are very strong and then very big in number and also in size. Therefore, their war was very weak according to their own understanding. Therefore, from there you find a person called Goliath. So Goliath-like people were there in the army of Philistines, and therefore they are called Nephilims. And this comes in the Genesis. I'll refer to that later. Genesis also talks about these giants who came from this descendants. And therefore, Goliath is one, and people like Goliath were there. And therefore, even Saul, the first king, was not able to control the enemy's attack or protect people. And therefore, he had a lot of problem. And he comes from the tribe called Benjamin. And he failed to understand God's heart. And this is exactly why God chose David. David knew the heart of God. He was very close to God. And he submitted his whole plan, everything to God. Therefore, David became a great warrior in the beginning of his life. Now, you come with David. After Jonathan's death, that is Saul's son, Jonathan's death, Jonathan was also a close friend of David. And when he died, there was no heir to his throne. Therefore, by the time David was also prepared to become a king, and he already killed Palestinians and their warriors like Goliath, and now he becomes a major challenge to the throne of Saul. And therefore, God selects David through Samuel. And this is the story we know. And he becomes the second king of the great Israel. And he also comes from the family of the Boaz. And Boaz is his grandfather. And his son, Jesse shoots. That's the word used even in other prophecies. And he's also a good musician. And he was always soothing Saul when he was attacked by evil spirits. And he was also a killer of Goliath and Nephilims. And therefore, he becomes very strong. And he is also inevitable after King Saul's death. The death was very horrible for Saul and the whole family. And he was left with a crippled son. And therefore, there was no other way except to understand and take Israel under the leadership of David. And further, what we see is David was very good in his warfare, and therefore, first he takes control of Jerusalem. And Jerusalem was controlled by Jebusites. They are the earliest settlers of Jerusalem. And you see from Genesis, you find these stories. Jebusites were there, and they were taken over by the temple, the temple place, or the Zion, or the town of Jerusalem was controlled by David. That was the first thing he does, and he comes with ark, and he establishes ark in that place called Jerusalem. And the temple was not built at that time. And according to the covenant, he brings this covenant to this place, Zion, and there it was the center of southern kingdom called Judah. And later on, when the land was divided between between Solomon's son and also Israeli north occupation, that is Samaria, the land of Judah is controlled by the rulers from Jerusalem and the temple, and temple becomes very stronger place. Therefore, political situation of northeast was north this country is very weak. Therefore, it favored David. It favored David, and the north places of Israel, for example, even he goes up to Mesopotamia or the Babylon. So David was very powerful, and he even takes some time to south also, to Egypt also. He took control of Canaan, that is Palestine, and Edom is another place, and then Moab to the west, to the east is Moab, and Ammon, all these countries comes after the Jordan River, and also north you have Aramean kingdoms, and these were controlled by David itself. David becomes very strong, and God allows Solomon to build the temple, not David. Therefore, he even takes control of Mesopotamia and also Egypt. Now, Solomon comes to power during 971 to 931 BC. That was the period Solomon. Within David's family, you find a lot of problems. Family problems are there. And Bathsheba and Prophet Nathan, they become very strong in selecting Solomon as the king, because Absalom and other sons were there, and they were not true to their God, actually. And that's the problem. And they were not serious of taking over David's throne. But Solomon becomes choice of God, and therefore he becomes the king, and Israel becomes very rich and very mighty during the time of Solomon. He built temple palaces because of his political contacts, and he married many women from other places, and therefore they were brought into the capital Jerusalem, and he takes a big project of building palaces, and the temple is also a bigger project for him to build temples, because once there is a political stability in Israel, and King Solomon started building the palaces and also the temple, and he finishes temple according to the plan, and he is also part of raising many taxes. So this becomes a big issue for them. Politically, this is a strategy. You know, once kings and rulers, the administrators become strong, they try to build something. They try to expand their kingdom. They want to expand their infrastructure, roads, forts, and things like that. So when Solomon was in power, Israel was stabilized in economy, stabilized in military warfare, and there was a peaceful atmosphere around that place. Therefore, Solomon takes the new projects called temple, fort, and other palaces and things like that. Therefore, he needed money, and then therefore the taxation was too high, and there was extraction of labor, forced labor, and it is called mass. It is called mass. The forced labor is called mass. And he brought many people from other lands. Therefore, accommodation was a big problem in Jerusalem. So he started building Jerusalem, a new Jerusalem kind of situation. And he also began to the empire began to crack because of his policies, political policies, and also the economic policies, particularly tax. Heavy tax was put on to people. Therefore, Jesus also remembers this kind of, you know, taxation. Somebody asks him to pay tax, is the right thing or wrong, and Jesus says, whatever is due to Caesar, you give to Caesar. Whatever due to God, you give to God. Therefore, that means taxation was accepted as one of the religious duties of Israel. And this is the first time Solomon introduces this tax on people. And that becomes a controversy, political controversy. And therefore, the emperors and the empire cracks down slowly. He was an emperor, and he had many lands around him, and they used to bring gifts and tithes to king. But now due to heavy tax, the kingdom is going to be in pieces. Therefore, from there onwards, you have northern kingdom, that is Israel, and southern kingdom, Judah, becomes very important. He died and split takes place. Northern tribes made Rehoboam as their king, that is in Israel. Samaria is their capital, and his son the king, and Samaria becomes the capital, and Jeroboam, he becomes the king in the south, and further he was supported by Ahijah and also Siloah. The Kings chapter 11, 26 to 32, you find these stories. And political unrest was continuing very fast in Israel, both Israel and Judah, and it destroyed the very image of God due to these divisions, and there was no control over the religious practices during this time, and the kings like Ahab and Jezebel were there in northern kingdom in Samaria, and that was the tragedy of the people. And later on, the Samaritans were Samaritan region was attacked by the northern kingdoms, Assyrians, and they took over Samaria. And by the time Neo-Babylonians, what we found in later period, the Neo-Babylonians from Babylon, particularly Nebuchadnezzar, he came to south, like he goes to Pharaoh's, and also on the way back he comes to Jerusalem, and he will occupy Jerusalem, and also he will destroy the temple, and he loots everything in the temple and takes the whole thing to Babylon. And by captivity, many people are taken to Babylon, and that's how the story of Daniel comes into existence. And also Psalm 137, he talks about the Babylonian waters. Thereby, people were taken as captives to this Babylonian kingdom, and thereby it ends with that. And during the time of Cyrus, again in Babylon, the will of God again works through people like Nehemiah and Ezra, and they bring orders from the King Cyrus, and then they come to Jerusalem and they watch the destruction of the temple and also the walls of Jerusalem, and they start building. That's how build and rise and build. So this kind of rhetorics, theological rhetorics, historical rhetorics begins. Therefore, again the kingdom of God again takes place during the time of Nehemiah and Ezra. And by that time you have more problems after 100 years of the new temple, which comes during the time of Ezra and Nehemiah. Again the fall begins, therefore, and it comes under Alexander. Now they are called Maccabean Wars, and this book, Maccabean stories, comes in intertestamental period after Malachi the prophet. There is a gap of 300-400 years, and you find these stories of Maccabean stories, where Hellenes or Alexander, he occupies the whole world at the time. Even he comes to India, and in his way back he'll die, but before that he occupies this land of Israel or the people of Israel, and their successors, and Alexander's successors are called Diadochi, or they are called Ptolemies in Egypt, Antiochus in Antiochus also, Syrians and Babylonians are also occupying those lands, and finally it comes under Epiphrates during 175 to 163, and Jews, they fight these wars heavily, and they were called Maccabeans. Maccabeans simply means hammer, or the warfare. So therefore, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, you understand this history from facts which are already existing in reading the Bible, and also you have archaeological evidences. For example, Alexander's story is very clear, historically proved, and there is nothing you can contradict on that. And the Roman world is also very clear, and what happened to the kingdoms during and after Alexander, that was also referred in Bible. And basically one thing we need to understand is everything works under God's control, under God's will, because kings were appointed by God. God never rejected people's opinion. He takes the opinion of the people, the necessities. At the same time, God wants to have his control, divine control over every ruler, every judge, every prophet, every king, every God's person. And it happens from the time of patriarchs to the time of Jesus. Therefore, the history of Israel is very political, is very religious, and also it also has a lot of theological implication on the life and the history of the people. Therefore, this history is very in brief. And if you have any clarification, you can just send questions. And we'll go to the second session now. Now, second session, we will be understanding whatever I close now. Reverend Reuben will take over the second session, and he will speak about the introduction to the New Testament, the Jesus time, and how things came into existence from the Old Testament, from intertestamental period, that is Maccabean, after Maccabean period, what happens next. So he is going to take over this as the second session. I thank all the viewers for attending this session, giving your attention. Thank you. We'll resume after 5 minutes.
Good morning, friends, and greetings to you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Today I'm very happy to be part of this FMA, where I've been invited to introduce the New Testament, the basic precepts of New Testament to you all. And therefore, I'm really thankful to Dr. Manoj Chandra Prasad for this opportunity. I'm very happy that in sharing. Good morning, friends, and greetings to you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Today I'm very happy to be part of this FMA, where I've been invited to introduce the New Testament, the basic precepts of New Testament to you all. And therefore, I'm really thankful to Dr. Manoj Chandra Prasad for this opportunity. I'm very happy that in sharing with you the knowledge that I have, I've got an opportunity once again to brush up my academia and to be part of this so that I can share what I've learned and invite you also to discover this beautiful word of New Testament. Before we could begin this session, shall we all look to God in prayer? Gracious and loving God, we thank you and praise you for this beautiful day and for this beautiful opportunity where we all come together to learn and to grow as we try to enter into this New Testament word to understand not only our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, but also the world which surrounds this entire New Testament. We pray that you would pour out your wisdom so that we can learn together to discern things within the text as well as within our context. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thanks a lot. Okay. Friends, as it has been written, today's topic is Introduction to the New Testament. The New Testament is a collection of various literary works, starting from the Gospel writing, which is very unique in its literary form, followed by the Acts of Apostles, which talks about the early church, how they started, how the church got established, how the missionaries went to the known then world, preaching the gospel and establish churches, then followed by Paul's letter, along with other evangelists who shared their experience in establishing churches and guiding churches, that is the other letters, followed by finally the Revelation, which we call it as Apocalypse. Before I could start, I have a few diagrams. I would like to make a basic comment saying that to enter into New Testament, it is not just the time in which we travel, but we also have to remember the space. And that's why I'm trying to have written this map, so that we can not only travel thinking about Jesus through our faith to a time unknown, but also we should be very clear about the space. The time and space is very important. To understand the New Testament world itself, we need to begin looking at the history of this particular region, what we call it as Palestine. This is the Mediterranean Sea, the Jerusalem, Galilee, Antioch at the north, and then Egypt, to show a smaller map. The history of the entire New Testament can be understood only when we look or locate the entire text into one particular situation. If we read the Gospels or the letters, every author has his own context from which he derives certain understanding about Jesus Christ, and then he has a certain audience who are confronted with certain one particular context, which would be either Roman Empire or Hellenization. And in that context, the author, the writers are trying to convey something to the audience. It is in this framework we need to understand the New Testament itself. I've divided three important eras, which is very, very important for us to understand the very New Testament itself. One is 334 BC to 162 BC, what we call it as Hellenism or Hellenization. You might be wondering what it is, like what we call today, or the previous generation used to say industrialization, and now globalization or post-globalized world. So similarly, we are locating this Hellenization as a foundation for our beginning to understand New Testament. After Hellenization, I'll be talking about the Maccabean Revolt and then the Roman Empire. It is here we will find the very books of the New Testament, or even we would be able to understand the birth and the mission or the work of Jesus Christ himself. So this becomes very important to understand the entire environment of the New Testament world. Many times when we read Bible, we seldom understand this concept. We try to jump in to the New Testament as if it was written to this context, to our audience, and they had everything in their mind about this world. But it is not true. We need to understand this historical situation or historical time and space, where we will be able to understand not only the authors, the writers, or the gospel writers, but also the message in itself. Hellenism. Alexander the Great, from 334 BC, we see that he not only conquered the then known Greek world, but he also introduced so many new things. It is from this era the entire world, at least the Eastern world, what we call it, the Eastern world, was changed in its understanding from the Old Testament itself. It is not just Alexander who brought this new idea or philosophy or lifestyle called Hellenization. It is earlier to that, Greek, or from Greece, Hellenism took its own root. People traveled because of commerce, people were trying to do business, and due to economic reason, this entire concept of Hellenism came into existence. That is, people started speaking Greek and using this as a main language for business and various purposes. So this started at least in the year 334 BC itself. But it was in 323 BC that Alexander the Great, Alexander, he conquered the then Greek world, which also includes the Palestine itself. He came all along with the soldiers and conquered the entire nation. So after conquering this particular space, he also introduced what we call it as Hellenism. Hellenism is nothing but the Greek culture, the Greek philosophy, which was introduced outside the Greek world or the then Greek world. And wherever they went, they introduced this Greek philosophy or Greek ideology, and that's what we call it as Hellenism. Hellenization is something that was imposed on people. Whether people accepted or rejected, it's a different question. But Hellenization is something that was imposed. People were forced to embrace this idea, the Greek idea of our lifestyle. This forcefulness was imposed during the time of Alexander, and then people started to follow that. First, let me talk only the political situation, and then we'll get into the social and the economic aspect of Hellenization. Alexander ruled for very few years, and after Alexander, this particular region, because this is what we are interested in, we are not interested in the entire Greek world, we are trying to understand the New Testament, particularly here in the Palestinian region. This world was conquered by Alexander, and then after Alexander, this kingdom was divided into three parts. But for us, two important divisions are noteworthy. One is Seleucid, and the other is Ptolemy. The northern region was taken by Alexander's successors of one particular region, what we call it as Seleucids, or people who were living in Antioch. They took over this region. The southern region, that is Egypt, it was taken over by Ptolemy. So this land was always in tension, because the southern region ruled by Ptolemy and the Seleucids, they were always fighting for this particular land, because this land was fertile and they were very much interested in making trade routes to get more financial and particularly the political benefits. So it was in tension all the time till the year 162 BC. After 162 BC, these three kingdoms were divided further, and in that division, somehow the Greek lost its battle against the Maccabeans. Maccabeans are part of the Jewish land, who were the revolts. They did not accept this Hellenism or Hellenization, and these people fought against it. They fought continuously for more than 100 years, and it was in 163 BCE that these people were able to grab the land. They were able to enjoy freedom or independence for a certain period of time. And after 62 BC, that is a brief period of time, probably a century, the Roman Empire entered this New Testament world, that is the Palestinian world. Once they entered this Palestinian world, they continued to conquer and they continued to rule over this land, and people were always subjugated to these, especially two main powers, earlier the Hellenistic power, now the Roman Empire. This is the political scenario or the framework in which we are trying to understand the New Testament world, from 334 BC to the first century and the later part of the period. Now, coming to the very aspect of Hellenization or understanding Hellenization, there were a few important aspects that brought in change in the very lifestyle of the Jewish people. This not only brought in change within the lifestyle, but in also in their thought patterns. This created many times divisions, but also sometimes unification among their own tribes or among the very people of the land. Hellenization brought three major changes. One is it brought us lifestyle. Hellenization created this ideology. Whoever follows the Greek culture are the most educated or cultured people. Or else, if people do not fall under this Hellenization or this lifestyle, they were called as barbarians. So people tend to follow this lifestyle and many people embraced it or welcomed it. Simultaneously, we also have evidence that some people did not embrace it. Now, we need to know that at times of exiles, people of this land were taken away to different places, either the northern part or the southern part. When they were taken away, generation together, people lived in their what we call it as diaspora, in that particular land, but still followed the Jewish religion. However, due to this Hellenization, people embraced Greek as the superior language and the culture. So people outside the Jewish land no more remembered their Hebrew language, but rather they were very comfortable in understanding or speaking Greek language. It was few parts that people were able to read Hebrew only during the worship service. So this is very important. This changed the entire lifestyle. It changed the education system. This changed the education system. People also started, there were three layers in which people started getting educated. At the beginning, people were encouraged at the childhood days to get into arts, cultural works, and so on and so forth. Then they were also sent to gymnasium, a lifestyle where people were given more preference for exercise, and it also had the other aspects within gymnasium. And then they were also sent, the third stage, they were sent for rhetorics, what we call it as arguments, and then you need to think, you need to argue to convey your message, and that's how people built their own knowledge. So these lifestyles changed the very nature of the then Palestinian world. So simply, it is a vast subject, but just to make you understand simply that this small place was conquered again and again. In the New Testament, what we are interested is the Greek conquest and then the Roman conquest. In between, we see still a little bit of independent local people conquering this world. Hellenization was the turning point in the entire process of thinking, entire process of writing, entire process of translating the very book of God or the Jewish sacred book. For example, it was during the Hellenization period they introduced Septuagint, what we call it as 70 people writing the Old Testament in Greek language, because people away from the land could not understand Hebrew and they wanted something where they can understand from their day-to-day language, that is Greek, and therefore they started translating the Hebrew Bible into Greek. And if you look at the Hebrew Bible and the Greek Bible, there will be certain philosophical, certain etymological changes due to this language change. And this made them to understand the entire Judaism in a different way. Now, understanding Hellenization, was it good or bad? It is very debatable, but how was it accepted? Most of the people, at least around the Jewish world, most of the people embraced it. They welcomed it because they did not have any other choice. Because of this notion, this is a very superior culture, and by learning this Greek philosophy or lifestyle or the language or this education system being part of it, you become superior, and therefore they were compelled, and they also thought it's good, change is always good, and they embraced it. Some of them, they did not know what to do. They were not sure whether it is right or wrong, but due to the daily affairs, they had to accept it, though they might spiritually say, or because of their religious attitude, the Jewish people, they might say, we don't like Hellenization or Hellenism, but anyway, we can't get rid of it, therefore we will embrace it. But very few people, especially people of the land here, they did not embrace it, because it changed the entire understanding of worship. It changed the entire understanding of who God is all about. So they were very rebellious. They did not accept it, and that's where we saw this Maccabean revolt. They totally rejected it. They fought against it, and they also hated the Greek who embraced this Hellenization, due to which there were major wars taking place. People died, and people who were not negotiating with each other, and therefore people rejected each other, and there was huge confusion within this land itself. I would like to draw your attention to this Maccabean revolt. This Maccabean revolt started from one person, then by a family, and then it moved on to many groups. It also paved way to many sects. And among these sects are the one we see, what we see more in the gospel, or especially in the gospel lesson itself, particularly in the synoptic gospels. We see of these sects that emerged as Sadducees, Pharisees, Samaritans, and Essenes, then Qumran. There were many sects that emerged as small groups with their own understanding of God, about waiting for Messiah, their response to this invitation, or their response to this Hellenization itself. These sects had their own understanding, and it was also classified in a very hierarchical manner. The Sadducees were considered to be something superior, the Pharisees then, and then came the Essenes, then the Qumran community, and the Samaritans. These people had problems within each other because of a little bit of faith differences. For example, the Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection, while the Pharisees, they believed in the resurrection. The Essenes had their own understanding. Qumran community, a small community, they didn't want to be part of this world, so they isolated to the Dead Sea, and they formed themselves as a very disciplined group. They dedicated themselves in writing recording their beliefs itself, what we call it as didache. And then came the Samaritans, the northern region, Samaria. Samaritans were another kind of people who were considered by the Jews or the Pharisees as neither Gentiles nor Jews, because they were considered to be mixed in their marriage and in their blood, and therefore they were not considered either Jews or the Gentiles. So they were isolated, they were rejected by the southern part of the Judea, and they were not allowed to worship in Jerusalem, and therefore they also believe they have a separate mountain called Gerizim, and there they will worship together. Friends, thus far we have just tried to understand the political world of the New Testament, that is before the New Testament writing could take place, so that we will be able to understand under what political situation it was written. And I'm sure in the coming days, even if you find it difficult right now, in the coming days you will be able to understand if you read either Gospels or the letters or even the book of Revelation, out of which context it was written, to whom it was written, why it was written. That political explanation what I gave will give you a basic understanding of how the world was, at least politically. Another aspect that I wanted to bring in here is the understanding of school and education. I already told you there were new systems of education because of Hellenization. There were gymnasium, there were also other learning centers. Then the second part was gymnasium, where people came, they exercised, they had other clubs within the gymnasium. And then they were also a kind of post or the third grade, which was more of rhetoric, more of argument, more of writing, and more of literary work, which took place. Simultaneously, I want you to remember, there was also a certain school system. We do not have an exact evidence within the scripture itself, but somehow we get a window, we get a way in which we can understand there must have been school system in Jesus' time. One is that we see in Luke chapter 2 verse 46 that as Jesus was a young boy and along with his parents when he visited Jerusalem, He sat with the elders in the temple and he questioned or he argued. It shows that there was a system in which this learning took place within Jewish people. And due to Hellenization, the school also was divided into two. There were some group which was called as Hillel and another one was Shammai. This will surely help you in understanding while we read scripture, locating certain people from which school they might have come and why they are arguing, why this discussion or argument with Jesus takes place. And that's the reason why I'm bringing these two schools. It shows we have evidence in the New Testament that there were two groups called Hillel and Shammai. And these two groups are, one is liberal and the other one is conservative. I'd like to give one example. For example, the liberal school, it said a man could divorce his wife if she merely burnt his food. For simple reason, it gave chance for, like, a man can divorce. Even if he has a complaint about his food, he can divorce his wife. Whereas the other school was very conservative. It did not accept this, but rather it said they thought that a husband could divorce his wife only because of unchastity, the sole ground for divorce in Jewish law. Only because of unchastity you can divorce. So within Jewish people or Judaism, there were two groups of understanding. One, a liberal school and a conservative school. And this is what we see in this in gospel as well. Some people coming with liberal questions, accepting certain things. Some people more aggressive because they were very conservative and they wanted to argue with Jesus about your stance, about your understanding of law itself. Keeping aside this school of education, now I want to talk about the social and economic conditions. Again, I'm saying many of you, because since you have entered this theological world within the church level, you might be wondering, why do we need all this? Is there a requirement to understand these? But if you ask me, or if you could really politely think further, it does make a sense to understand not only the world of New Testament, but all the arguments, all the situations in the New Testament, how it is tied up. And probably I will try to give examples within the scripture itself. Now, the social and the economic conditions. First, I would like to talk within the Jewish people or Judaism, and then the Roman understanding. The social condition. There were hierarchies. There was hierarchy. The Sadducean temple priests were considered to be topmost. The next came the Pharisees, who also were just below the Sadducean priests. And then came the Essenes. Then the others were all able to have some access to this ladder. And then came the outcast, who did not even have an opportunity to enter the temple or be part of that conversation. So this was the ladder in which they operated. It is the scene, the high priest or the Sadducean priest, temple priest, were considered topmost because they were given, for example, by the Roman government, or when people were conquered from the southern part of Egypt, that is the Ptolemy's government, or the Seleucids from the northern part. These people acted on behalf of them. They were given kind of authority to follow not only their religion, and through that to have some kind of authority over the rest of the group itself. The Pharisees were also part of it, but they were socially less in their ladder, and everything operated in this understanding of purity and pollution. So this is the basic understanding. Based on this, there was this hierarchy. So the Pharisees also were dealing with some of the financial matters, like you will see Jesus conflicting them. And you will also see within the temple structure, Jesus entering the temple and saying that now it has become the den of robbers instead of this house to be called my God's house. So these criticisms, you can see this hierarchy in them. And then came the Essenes, then the others, then the outcasts. For example, the beggars, those who could not enter the city, the lepers, and all the other people. This is just a brief hierarchy. If you want any details, I can give you the material, or you can also find or browse for at least for the basic material, the social ladder. Within this Roman Empire, there were also social ladders. At the top was the emperor. Emperor was nothing but equal to God. He was the representative of God. Next came the partisans, that is the higher upper class people who were financially rich. Because of their finance, they were all able to grab this position. Then came the senators, who also became who were trying to mediate between these two groups and the lower people in the ladder. Then came the plebeians, that is the common people. Then came the free people. They were working, they were very poor, but the only difference is they were free. And then came the slaves. Slaves, they did not have any freedom. They had to obey their master. And this argument of slavery, free people, common people, you will find more in the writings of Paul itself. Addressing these problems, how to understand, how to deal with social issues. This we need to understand within, I can just give you an example, this as within our context, the way we have a social ladder in terms of caste system. This similar way, or in a different manner, in that particular world, they had the social ladder. Nobody could get into the other ladder, because it was also within the family. They carried their own works, Pharisees, Essenes, everything, and it was very hard to really get out of their own financial or social situation. The same was here with the Roman social structure. So, to have a small framework, there was hierarchy. Higher, lower, accepted, rejected, whether to be included as insider, outsider, all these things we see in the New Testament. Who's the insider, who's the outsider? And similarly, in terms of finance, this is how it worked. Because of this hierarchy, there was this tax system. Tax system played a major role. And this entire system created a binary between the rich and the poor. The rich were always remaining rich, but it was almost difficult and impossible for the poor to really get or catch up into that level of the social or the economic ladder. This tax system we will also see in the gospel. So when we read this tax system, it's not just like any other tax system. It was also an imposed tax system which served the interest of the emperor. So the tax system served the interest of the emperor and not the interest of the people. Well, that's what we need to understand. And similarly to this tax system, within the temple also, they had this offertory, a financial system where it did not serve the purpose of the people, or it did not help the very lifestyle of people. Rather, it was only building up more and more treasury in the temple. For example, in Luke's gospel, we see Jesus countering the Jewish people and recognizing a poor widow, countering that entire economic system where the rich give out of abundance, and because of that abundance they were able to give more, and they thought that was more pleasing to God. But Jesus reverses, saying that it is this widow's offering, out of everything what she gives, God has accepted, and her offering becomes very, very important. Just an example for you to understand. The tax system, within this financial tax system, we also see like Zacchaeus, who gets to whom Jesus says, today the salvation has come to your house. And then how Jesus responds to the situation, and how Zacchaeus responds to Jesus' invitation. How this mixture of conversation took place among people, and how few were able to accept it and few were not able to accept it. Within this financial system, we also see that Jesus, in his ministry, somehow, for various reasons, could not attract the rich people in his mission. Very few people could have followed Jesus It is largely the poor people who are able to understand and embrace Jesus' message. For example, the rich young man, he comes to Jesus seeking for wisdom, seeking for something good, and he knows that Jesus has something to offer, but he goes with disappointment because he could not accept this entire economic system of what Jesus was talking about. Whereas we see Judas seems to be a little bit doing better economically. He comes to Jesus, but I don't want to talk about the end. We also see Zacchaeus once again. He responds to Jesus' message and embraces Jesus' message. And in Acts of Apostles, we see Cornelius, who accepts this entire understanding of what Jesus had taught. But very few rich people accepted this entire Jesus' teaching because it was not pleasing to them, and it was also countering the entire system of what was taking place. So here I would like to end the political, the social, and the economic condition of the New Testament. This condition, to conclude, that this economic situation, condition in the then Palestinian world, it created more poverty, and that's why we see many poor people in the Gospels who came to Jesus looking for some kind of deliverance, looking for some kind of solutions, and Jesus himself confronting now and then in this entire economic system of how cruel it was and it used to be. These are all very important because now when we read, this gospel becomes alive to us, so that we also see within our context how Jesus' context and the response during Jesus' context can be so helpful to us in today's context itself. So I will just end up here, and then I will try to introduce you to the Gospels and then the problems within the Gospel itself. Friends, now we will try to understand what gospel is and why gospels were written. And if we have enough time, I will try to introduce to one of the gospels, that is Mark's gospel. Chronologically, looking at the New Testament, we do not find gospels to fall at the beginning. But in scripture, we see the gospels at the very beginning of the New Testament. Chronologically, after the death of Jesus, 30 AD. There was a period of oral tradition, what we call it as oral tradition. There was no writing. People started talking about Jesus' death and resurrection. And from there, people started talking, and then wherever people went, they established communities, not only within the Palestinian region, but also the outside of Palestine. Wherever they went, they introduced or they formed a community, and which was later considered or called as Christian communities. So they had oral traditions to carry further of what Jesus taught. Every individual had their own stories to say, those who met Jesus or those who had conversations, and they carried further here and there wherever they went. After this oral tradition, we see the emergence of letters. Probably it is the Pauline letter. Started with Paul's letters, wherever community was formed, when they had some spiritual or what we call it as theological questions, Paul wrote a letter because he was a learned person and he was able to discern, and he himself, because of his encounter with Jesus, was able to really transform his life, understand his life, dedicated his life every time to understand and the situation and to respond to the situation. After this period, there was a fading away of a generation. When people were fading away, they had to keep up this entire tradition, and they wanted to know who Jesus was. The following generation wanted to know what was Jesus all about. And that's when we see the Gospels were written. Generally, it is understood the Gospels were written between 70 AD to 120 AD. There are differences, but this is generally accepted all over, 78 to 128. What is a gospel? A gospel in English, understanding, it seems to be something about saying good or a story about God. Anglo-Saxon means it's about a story about God. If you look at the very Greek word, euangelion, it means good news or glad news. The good news, what is the good news? That good news is all about Jesus. Jesus himself is the good news. So people started writing about the life of Jesus. What was Jesus? How was he? What did he encounter? With whom did he talk? What was his mission? Where did he travel? And then how did he die? Why did he die? How was he resurrected? Various questions came in a form of a book or a literary work. And we see the generally accepted is Mark's gospel to be one of the earliest gospel. And then comes Matthew, Luke and John themselves. So Mark becomes the starting point for inquiring the gospel or understanding the gospel, because Mark believed to have written it in 70 AD. It is during this time the Jewish people had war with the Roman Empire, and we also believe it is in the history itself that during this time the temple was destroyed. People did not have an identity of their own, a religious identity, and during this time that Mark also writes his gospel. So why gospels were written? Why was it written? As I told you earlier, it was written to have an understanding of what or who Jesus was. Every gospel writer has his own understanding of Jesus. And that is very, very important as we read scripture, particularly the gospels itself. What we see in Mark will be different, what we see in Luke will be different, what we see in Matthew will be different, and what we see in John will be different. Yet they are all unified, yet there are connectivities. But their audience, the place where they wrote, the purpose for which they wrote, totally differs. And that is why we see that in all the three gospels, what we call it as synoptic gospels, there are parallels and there are something specific or special, or what we call it as unique from each other. And this understanding differences, we call it as synoptic problem. Once again, I would like to draw your attention. We have tried to understand what gospel is, a brief introduction that it is a good news. It comes from a Greek word because the Greek people used this word as something news which comes from an emperor or within the Roman Empire. News is something good news. Similarly, they use it as the very life of Jesus is a good news, and that's why they use this word gospel. It's not about the story of God, but it is surely a good news about Jesus Christ himself. Then comes why gospels were written. We see that every gospel has its own intention, purpose, audience to which it has been written. And now we have just come to this synoptic gospels, because Matthew, Mark, Luke are totally different from John, because John has a different literary form, different intention and different stories to tell us all about. Whereas Matthew, Mark, Luke has something common together, but they are also unique. And this makes the New Testament very very diverse in nature. And this is very, very important in our theological journey or in our spiritual journey. The very New Testament world is so diverse because it has different practices, different understandings. It comes from a diverse places, different places, but unified together. And this aspect is very important in this learning. Now I would like to talk about this synoptic gospels and the synoptic problems. What do we mean by synoptic gospel? Synoptic gospels are the first three gospels that we find in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They have some connections, synopsis, and that's why we call it as synoptic gospels. But at the same time, as I told you earlier, they are also unique in nature, which creates some kind of problem. And this is very important in the New Testament, where investigations are made, where new discoveries are made to argue, to understand the entire text in depth. For example, Matthew, Mark, Luke, I'll call it as MT, MK, and LK. It is earlier generally believed that Mark was the basis for both Matthew and for Luke. Because whatever is there in Mark, we find it in Matthew and Luke. So Mark and Matthew and Luke might have kept this as a textbook, as a basis to expand their own gospel writings. But within Mark, first we need to understand, it is through oral tradition. Everything was collected, formulated, organized, and kept together, and made it as a very gospel itself. But when it came to Matthew and Luke, along with Mark, there were also other oral traditions through which their text was formed at a different places, three different places. We see people writing their gospels. And the problem that we find within the synoptic gospels is whether Matthew and Luke had only Mark as their text, or are there any other traditions that can be attached along with these two sources, or this source, or with this basis itself. So there are different understandings. They say there are three traditions that Matthew along with Mark had oral tradition, and Luke had some other oral tradition. But some people also argue, along with these two, Matthew had a separate source which Luke was not aware of. And similarly, Luke also had a separate source which Matthew was not aware of. And that's why these parallels, but also something which is unique we find in the Gospels, what we don't find in the other texts. And that is the reason why this investigation continues to take place even in today's world. Still, if you're wondering, how is it going to help in this FMA course, how these things will help us in understanding scripture? I would like to just say one thing. What is important in this entire New Testament text is, we all should know how diverse it is. And to make it more spiritual, many times we think that, you know, one source or witness of one thing is very, very important. But New Testament shows God's, or what we believed as Bible, the very God's word, was not formulated by one person from one particular culture, from one particular experience, to say that this particular group or a person has legitimacy over the text, and that's why this particular text becomes very important or sacred. Bible clearly, especially New Testament, it shows it's so diverse. We cannot imagine the diversity through which it was formulated. Every single person becomes very important here. Every single tradition becomes very important here. People can criticize each other. Pharisees become important. Sadducees, they become important. The Essenes, they become important. Samaritans played an important role. The very outcast people, they play an important role. Everything forms together to bring in what we call it as a good news. And that is what I would like to probably end up with if time permits. Next time, if I get an opportunity, I would further lead you to some of the Gospels itself, in detail. So this diversity becomes very important at all times for us to understand the scripture. Probably I shouldn't be concluding like this, but I take the privilege to conclude in a simple form to make the students of the New Testament, like you and like me and like many of us, to understand this diversity within our own context. Because everybody talks about legitimacy. What is the legitimacy? We need legitimate evidence, legitimate things to have some kind of control, to have that so-called sacredness, which becomes very, very important in the space in where, in the space where we worship, in the space we where come together as one fellowship. This is very, very problematic. Very, very problematic, because in the Gospels and the letters, we see this entire notion has been challenged by Jesus himself and then the followers, the disciples, the apostles, and the others themselves, because of this supremacy nature. By understanding what I told earlier, the diverse nature, the political context, the economic context, the social context, it makes us understand how God becomes more alive in our day-to-day life. The very beginning I said, time. We are not just traveling in time to understand who Jesus or the people around him was or were, but we are also understanding space. Just like the time for FMA, every second Saturday becomes very important in learning together. The space in which, from where we learn, also becomes very important. The time defines the space, and the space also defines the time. These two go parallel. In breaking this legitimacy, highlighting the diversity of the New Testament, we try to live in a world where we would also appreciate and accept something new in our lives by learning from each other. This is what we see in the very New Testament world itself, or the literature itself. People not only said what they believed, but people also took something from their culture, from their experience, from their history, and they tried to mold it, and they tried to incorporate it, not fully everything, without compromising with the ideologies. They tried to incorporate it, and they tried to spread this good news. What is that good news? Peace be with you. The peace that comes from the Lord. And that is the good news through which they moved on. Today, with this class, probably I would like to say, the context in which we live, the pandemic context, where fear takes away our lives, where anxieties are trying to bring in some kinds of ups and downs, troubles in our life, where the so-called sacredness or the sacred spaces have been argued and occupied by many people as something that belongs only to us, is very problematic. Jesus breaks this very notion. Whatever considered to be so-called sacred, it is not that he wants to negate that, but he tries to expose the understanding of sacredness, which divides people, which creates not only hierarchy, but also creates a brutal lifestyle wherein which only few can survive, the others are not meant to survive or meant to live. Today, this, I believe, without making a very precise statement, but hoping that you will be understanding, this notion has created a difference in our world. And therefore, I would say, as you might be wondering what this class is all about, how to go ahead, if you want to go in detail, you can ask me, or you can just search through web, you will get more answers. This becomes very important in the very understanding of New Testament. Before we enter the text, of course we have entered the text, and because of the text we have come to this situation or circumstance where we want to know more about what we are learning, what our faith is all about. Yet now we need to approach, or you need to approach the text in a fresh manner, so that within the text it is not read in isolation, but it is read in its own contextual situation, the world in which it emerged, people's response to some of the brutality, some of the imperial powers, how people responded, how people continue to live in their faith, and how in today's context this text, within its context, can relate to our own context. where we can also carry this good news and further proceed in our life, witnessing the very life of Jesus Christ, life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Thank you. We do not have much time, therefore I just end up here. Given a chance, in the next class I will lead you further to some of the Gospels and other texts, or I'm sure that there are many other people who are expertise in this New Testament who will lead you all to a new session as well. Have a good day, and I believe that you all are able to understand. If you have any questions, please do contact me. Thank you very much.
So, briefly concluding the main events before Jesus, Maccabean War and also intertestamental period. Further, if you have any questions, you please send us so that if possible, I will answer those questions if it is pertaining to their own context, and then I will request our resource person to respond later. And once again, I thank Reverend Reuben for presenting this wonderful paper of a brief and total introduction to New Testament and Gospels. Reverend Reuben is a presbyter in charge of Christ Church, Chikbalapur. It is one of the biggest rural congregation in our diocese. And also it has many challenges for ministry, and I really appreciate Reverend Reuben for making possible to present this presentation at this hour. Thank you, Reuben, for that. Friends, now we'll come to our next session after 10 minutes. Reverend Job Jairaj is going to present us the family counseling, the theological and biblical importance of family counseling, and I request all of you to come back after 10 minutes. Thank you. Friends, we'll go to the new session that is led by Reverend Job Jairaj. Job Jairaj is retired presbyter from Church of South India, Karnataka Central Diocese. He was one of the resource persons earlier in the field of counseling, and today he will be presenting a paper on family counseling, which has biblical and theological significance for our ministry. Now I welcome Reverend Job Jairaj and all the viewers and the participants of FMA program on counseling. Thank you very much.
Hello everyone, hope you are doing good in the past, keeping yourself safe at home. Let's continue to stay at home till the lockdown is totally over. Hello everyone, hope you are doing good in the past, keeping yourself safe at home. Let's continue to stay at home till the lockdown is totally withdrawn, and may God help us to live according to His will. Today we are going to have a brief discussion on family and family counseling. A family is an intimate domestic group consisting of two adults who are the foundation of the family, that is a male and a female, from two different family, social, traditional, economic, religious backgrounds. They join in marriage, and as all of us know, marriage is a gift of God and instituted by God to continue His creative activity. Every couple who had joined in marriage is expected to hold this union in honor, because God has a purpose in uniting these two individuals, a male and a female. And it is expected of these two people to honor God and also respect one another, express their love and affection to one another, share whatever resources they have with one another and together to the family, for the betterment of family and betterment of the fellowship and relationship as well. By way of joining in marriage and sharing their intimacy, they add one or more individuals to their domestic group, which we call it as a family. So it becomes a social unit, members of the human society. As said before, those two adults who are joined in marriage as husband and wife, since hail from different backgrounds, will have different opinions on various family matters because they are new. Though they were living in a family setup, experiencing their parents, their siblings' life, but this new relationship brings them different and varied experiences, difficult times, and hence they have to sit and discuss as to how to lead the family that they have established. As they grow in their relationship and intimacy, they are expected to grow in maturity as well. When I say maturity, it is not aging, but experiencing the new relationship God has established, new challenges that they are facing, and new ideas they have to share with, and all these things contribute to the growth of maturity and establishing a good and godly family. By this way, finding appropriate ways and means to their differences. I'm not saying it is difficult to face, but differences, it is natural for any two individuals be it male and female or female and female or male and female, anything for that matter, differences will be there. But sorting out the differences makes them more mature and grow mature as well. So in spite of the differences, they are expected to share their love and affection, giving up something for the happiness of both and for the establishment of the family. Some couples are capable of accommodating and managing the situation very well. Some find it hard, some find it difficult, some take their own time. But whatever it may be, the couple are expected to find appropriate means and ways to find an amicable settlement and solution. While finding a solution, I'm not saying that they need to go out of the four walls and the matter should go out of both of them to either of the parents or friends or relatives or anyone for that matter, because the third person who comes may not know the full background of your problem and they may be biased. So it will be better for the couple to find the amicable settlement among themselves. If at all they are not able to, then they need to find a person who could understand fully both of them and then be a mediator to say, husband, you have done this wrong, or wife, you have done this wrong. Why don't you give up? Why don't you consider this way to find the solution? That should be the attitude of the person who mediates or who is invited to mediate between the couple to find a solution. So, as said before, some not capable or willing to get adjusted and manage their differences, spill or share with another person, allow that person either to help them to find a better solution or make the situation worse. When the solution is not able to get the desired solution, then the worst thing creeps in, not only between those individuals, that is husband and wife, but also between husband and wife and the person whom they have invited to solve the problem. When such people realize that the situation need to be solved, they approach an individual who is capable of bridging the gap between them. Or such couple make up their mind that there is no way they could live together anymore, approach the court. Alas, they end up in separation and or divorce, which is not the desire of the parents of either of the couple. If that capable individual were to be you as a counselor, then there comes an opportunity for you to be the representative of the one who joined them into this holy estate to bring them again to that one and united status. Friends, please do not or try to find out as to who was the person who was the reason for this undesirable situation, but make them to feel and accept that both have their share for this problem. Help them to recollect how they started their life, day one onwards, week one onward, month one onward. How did they start and how did they continue to live? They would have probably planned for an outing after a week or after a month, depending upon their resources. Whatever it may be, they need to realize that the problem was brought by both of them. They have their own share. So help them to recollect as to how the problem started, after their married life, the first few years and the experiences that they have shared, the love and affection, the intimacy they shared before the problem could creep in more or develop more. Maybe till the first baby born, they had very smooth sailing. Maybe after that, the problem would have started. But whatever it may be, the new member has not created the problem. It is, or it was, both husband and wife, now the parents, they are reason or reasons for this situation. Okay, they have shared their experiences before the birth of the first child and then continues even at the time of second baby conceived. Probably if at all they want to have, then they have third as well. So amidst the problem, they continue to live together, thinking that the problem will be solved. But if it continues, both have to sit across the table to analyze who should be taken care of and how it should be solved. Whenever you feel to appreciate them as a counselor, do it. Well, you both managed so far with a good heart, with a good mind, with a good intention, with a good desire. So why don't you continue to develop that attitude to find an amicable solution to your problem? Own the problem and own the solution, because it was both of you who started and who need to find the solution as well. You did share your joy and affection. You did share your love and happiness so far. And why don't you continue to find the same way to continue with the happiness, joy, love and affection even in the days to come? Also, my dear friends, help them to share as to how they felt about that joy and happiness now. Because now, the joy and happiness they have shared is at risk. So help them, how was their mindset when they were able to share the joy and happiness? And let them know, let them understand that that is possible even now. So help them to know the problem is with both of them. Though there are innumerable examples in the Bible and on earth to mention about the disturbed individuals and families, please do not refer to those. In any form or type of counseling, the affected ones need to open up their mind to share the differences and allow them to choose solution offered to them from your suggestions. Please do not preach, evangelize, pray, and advise. Pray only when they desire or request for. Please do not force them to accept your views on anything, whether small or otherwise. As said before, each individual, even among the twins, is different in almost everything. But when it comes to friendship or relationship, each one decides to give up one or the other, if not fully, but depending upon the other individual, circumstance, one's own emotional and mental status at that moment and situation. Like that, each one of us come to a decision for the sake of maintaining the friendship and relationship. When such is the case, why not give up one or the other, if not fully, but depending upon the situation, but certainly to continue with the commitment that we have given before God and in the presence of God's people. So, because we have the desire to continue with the committed relationship as husband and wife we need to give up. Though either or both will have to shed or lose to an extent one's own self-respect, ego, yet it should be considered as a gain. A gain to improve on their love and affection and a little more stronger relationship. Yes, my dear friends, some of you are right. You will think that should I experience such a humiliation? Yes, some of you are right. I should, for the sake of the relationship, children, family, and social status, and so on and so forth, I should give up certain things. My dear friends, who in the world has not experienced hurt, humiliation, sadness, went to the extent of finding a permanent solution, that is to end their life? But each one realizes that the end result brought each other closer with one another than before. They wish to forget the bad experiences that they have had in the past. Someone, or maybe two, will have this thought: so far I have not seen the shadow of that end result that you are talking about. But going through the experiences of your parents, or looking at the experiences of your siblings, or knowing from your friends their experiences at time of this kind of differences, directionless move, you would have probably thought about it. What if I get, what if I come across such a situation? What should I do? Should I think and decide for myself, or should I sit across the table with my spouse and discuss? It should be that way, that discuss with one another before you could come, either of you could come to a conclusion or a decision saying that this is what I should do. No, because you're not a single person now. You're not an individual, but a couple, a husband and wife, or parents as that, for that matter. So when you have taken decision with discussing with your spouse in the past, why don't you apply similar thing even to the problem that you are facing? Leave alone whether the end result is going to be in your favor or in your spouse's favor, doesn't matter. As long as we want, or we have the desire to live together in spite of the differences of opinion, we have to give up certain things, as I said before, your self-respect and your ego and several other things which hinders the relationship, which brings blockage between you and your spouse. That should be the attitude, my dear friends. So when you are experiencing, as the counselor in your own lifestyle, say to you yourself, what if the couple needs some help from me? So they have come to you thinking that you will help them to overcome whatever situation they are in, whatever challenges they are facing. So with your experience, without saying that even I had this problem with my spouse, I've been like that, no, don't refer to anybody's instances, but taking cue from those experiences of your parents, of your relatives, of your friends, or of your own self, come to a conclusion saying that, why don't you consider this one? I'm just giving you a suggestion. You think about it, sit across the table. Maybe you plan an outing, maybe a short distance, leaving the child or children at home. Maybe stay overnight elsewhere where you find the place will be soothing to your problem, soothing your hurt, leaving some differences for the sake of the life together, the love and the affection that you need to share with the other person. So when such is the case, my dear friends, I'm sure God will help us, because He is the helper to everyone, and for Him and with Him, everything is possible. So, thanking God for uniting both of you in the family status, thanking God for the life that He has given you so far in spite of the differences, and He has been your helper, continue to put the trust in Him, because He is able to relieve you from the burden, relieve you from the botheration that you are undergoing, finding you appropriate suggestions, solutions to face the challenges. Friends, please do not, as counselors also, tell them that not to compare themselves with another couple or another family. That will ruin the peace of mind, because their life is different and your life is different as well. Your thinking is different, their thinking is different, their approach to the challenge is different, and your approach will be different as well. And the solutions that they find will be different as well from that of yours. So please do not compare to any individual or any couple or to any family. All that all of us, including myself, need to do is, whenever we come across a problem, let's approach God, because He is the author of our family. He is the source of every knowledge, and He is everything for us at every time. When God blessed us with so many things, did we say, "Thank you, God"? And if at all so, say the same thing to God. Thank you, God, for this experience, for this challenge. If you have anything to tell us through this challenge, through these difficult times, help us to understand one another. We are short of knowledge. We do not have wisdom to find solution. So we need your help, God. So please be with us. Guide us. We have none other than you as the counselor. Human counselors may misguide us, mislead us, may give a different direction, but you, as the author of our family, source of every blessing, we seek your guidance, we seek your counsel. So that should be the attitude of every couple who come across such difficult times. It may continue. I don't say that every problem will have a final solution. Definitely we desire to find an amicable solution. But what if we don't get an amicable solution in the short period? We wait for it. When we wait for certain things, we need to wait patiently, because we are waiting upon the Lord, who is the source of everything. So as I said before, please do not compare with anybody, with anything, because each individual is different. As I said before, even among the twins, definitely there will be differences of opinion. There will be different understanding of the same thing. We need to find a solution. That is our goal. That should be our aim as well as my dear friends. Yes, my dear friends, the end result doesn't come just like that or with no or less cost. For example, at a particular age or stage, each one of us would have had a desire to become a doctor, an engineer, IAS, IPS officer, a teacher, or even a priest like me. To reach my desire, I don't sit and pray, "God, bless me with all these things." God also allows us to sit and pray, but He wants or He expects us to take an initiative as well, a step forward. That is to say that I'm also responsible to reach that goal. For some, the desire seems to be unrealistic in our certain age or stage for a certain reason. See, for example, I had the desire of becoming a doctor, but because of my inability to cope up with the subjects, I could not. Then I did have another alternative plan. So similarly, when we think aloud and see that my goal is unrealistic, then I need to find an alternative. How to find the alternative? Again, think aloud. Think aloud. With my desire, with my abilities, is it possible to become an engineer, if not a doctor, if not an IAS officer, if not an IPS officer? Well, I don't say that only IAS, IPS, doctors and engineers have status in the society. Even people like us, teachers for that matter, because they are the foundation for our present life. So when such is the case, let us think aloud. What is the alternative? With my status, mindset, with my ability, with my knowledge, with my capabilities, what is the alternative? So we have the desire to find an alternative. So we think aloud. We see the pros and cons, ups and downs. And then we come to a decision with all the abilities, capabilities that I have. Okay, I find this is the suitable solution. In a similar way, both husband and wife need to find an alternative. Why we get into problems? Why we develop on the differences of opinion rather than finding a solution? So, as I said before, each one has his or her own share for the problem, so also to find the solutions. So, my dear friends, as I said before, then we need to think aloud and change the direction which will suit my desire, which will help me to reach my goal, and which will help me more stronger than before, and the energy that I gain with the past experience. So, with the experience that I had in the past and the renewed energy that I have gained, analyze the ways and means of failure, and now plan a different style of thinking and planning, and move ahead with a new or renewed commitment. That means sitting more often across the table to discuss various things, also the differences that has been developed in our mind. So find, listen to the other person as well. In counseling, maybe you would have heard, or maybe you will hear, listening is more important. When we have patience to listen to the other person, more problems are solved automatically. So develop that attitude to listen instead of jumping into conclusions, saying that whatever you say is wrong, absolutely wrong. No, nobody is absolutely right, nobody is absolutely wrong. At times, because of our emotion and the difference more stronger in our mind, we charge the other person, the spouse, saying that you are the root cause. No, we need to find an alternative, because this alternative will help you to draw closer to you, love the other person more closely, intimately. So by doing so, we will definitely gain strength together, because one hand cannot make sound, but two hands. Similarly, both husband and wife need to put their resources, need to put their strength together for the betterment of their relationship, their fellowship, family in total. So when this is the style of life to obtain a degree, to reach a goal, when we say that I could find an alternative, help them to find an alternative to the present situation, to reach what is set before them to accomplish their goal, to draw more closer to God in at the end. So because we have, as I said before, we have no other source than God to reach out at any situation. Similarly, either individually or together, willingly draw closer to God for His intervention in finding solution for the problem that they are facing. Not only to draw closer to one another, but also to set an example to our children. Children are the gifts from God. That's what we believe in. And we also pledge before God and the congregation that we will bring them up in a godly way to be called as the children of God. No human being or family is perfect, as all of us know, my dear friends. But we don't decide to remain in the same place and position. We develop a desire to lead a better life, improve our knowledge, to move forward, desire and decide to upgrade oneself, to gain a reward in the form of position or even monetary benefits, and so on and so forth. We have developed a desire. We have a plan to move forward. We have set up a goal to improve our lifestyle. We talk to one another and to come to an achievable style, achievable end. If we decide to buy or build a house, we need to improve our financial resources. We need to move forward. We bury every stumbling block in reaching our goal. We reach out to our close but confidential friends and relatives and get their help as well, and get their suggestions as well. We go to the relatives and get their help whenever required. We also go to the extent of approaching the bank for a loan to buy a house or to build a house, or even an extra financial help for that matter. We leave our ego behind us and approach friends or relatives or the bank. When such is the case, my dear friends, why not to lead a happy and healthy family life? Reach out to the fellow human beings, namely our spouse, because he or she is the first person to be reached out. Maybe confidential persons among the friends, among the relatives. Ultimately, as I said before, God Himself. Everything is possible with God. All that we need to do is have a desire, an achievable goal, a detailed plan and vision, self-confidence, and fully committed in faith and confidence upon God. I can, or we can do everything, God being our helper. That should be the faith commitment of both the husband and wife, not only for their happy and healthy life, but also for the healthy and happy life of the dear children. This is what we did when we were joined together as husband and wife, parents and children, in the presence of God and before the congregation. Keep renewing this commitment. That should be the attitude of every one of us as husband and wife, because God has united us. God has initiated this relationship between the couple. So it is necessary for all of us. Finally, I would like to end by saying, please prayerfully prepare yourself as the counselors for every session with sufficient information from both of them on the issue. If you think that you yourself is in need of help in this matter, then please either seek another expert or refer the couple to him or her. God bless you all. Thank you. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for giving us an opportunity to know something about the family and the family counseling. Help each one of us to draw closer to you whenever we face challenges, whenever we are in difficult times, and especially as counselors, when we begin to counsel the disturbed couple. Pray that you will be with us as our helper, the great helper, and find amicable solutions through your intervention. Take each one of us, bless us, and use to bring life and love among the disturbed people. Be their leader, be their guide and God. Be with us, Lord. Take us, mold us, and use us according to your will. In your loving name we pray. Amen.
This wonderful paper on family counseling and its theological and biblical importance for church ministry. Friends, some of you have sent some questions for clarifications. I try to answer those things, and if it is related to the subject and the resource person, we'll refer back to them and next sessions or sessions when we meet personally, we'll discuss those things. I'll try to answer some of your questions. Many of you sent a note for bringing the notes, New Testament notes and other notes also. We are trying, particularly Brother Christopher Praveen and Mr. Floyd Williams, they are trying to send notes through online, and it will reach you wherever possible. We'll collect the notes and then we'll send it to you. And Manuel Kaviraj has asked one question. He says, he's asking the history of Alexander the Great. Alexander is from Greek, and he's from Greece, place called Macedonia. And he is an emperor. He is not just a king. He's an emperor who conquered the world at a very early age. And he even travels the whole desert and then comes to places like Afghanistan and India. And we have Indian history showing that he fought the war with the Indian king. And he influenced Greek culture in India too, India and other places. It is called Gandhara. Gandhara culture means Greek influence on India. So the Hellenists were not just people who influenced Middle East, but it's their influence was all over Asia those times. Therefore, the Greek culture is a Hellenistic culture. And it is an imposing kind of culture. Therefore, Alexander the Great, he is responsible for spreading the Gandhara culture or the Hellenist culture all around the ancient world. Sumita Sumana, she asked a question that why Gospels were written, the reasons for writing Gospels. As I understand that there is a need to understand God. That was after intertestamental period. There was a crisis in the temple history, and that's what Reverend Reuben narrated as the background of New Testament Gospels, particularly why Gospels were relevant. Because according to him, he says the second the temple destruction was very severe. Temple was destroyed and there was no religion, though that is the time the vacuum of religious vacuum was filled up by gospel writers and the Christianity, the early church, the church in Jerusalem. So they were worshipping in their own places. So when temple was destroyed in 70 BC AD, there took place a new kind of religion called Christianity. And it is also the need was there to spread the gospel. That was the Great Commission, Matthew chapter 28, we see the last verses. He says, go into the world and make disciples. So discipleship needs really something, either oral or written tradition forms. So therefore, gospel is a must. Therefore, the Mark gospel becomes the earliest gospel written for the Christians in many places, particularly Jerusalem, Israel, Palestine, and other places like Antioch or in Rome and other places. Christianity was taking birth from Acts of Apostles chapter 2. You know, many people came from many nations and they were dispersed. At that time, I don't think gospel was written. Only oral tradition was there. People remembered whatever God, Jesus said about that. And therefore, the Mark, the first gospel writer, takes initiative writing the earliest scripture possible after the fall of temple. And therefore, that becomes the necessity for writing gospels. It's a very interesting and very good question. Reasons for gospel. And in future, we will take this in next session. Most probably, the New Testament second session will be on gospel according to St. Mark and other gospels, synoptic gospels. And again, Hellenist perspective, some questions are asked. We understand that during Hellenism, is there Septuagint and 70 people wrote the Old Testament? No, it is authorized number is 70 maybe, but Old Testament is not written by one source. That's very unique. There is a non-Jewish traditions were also added. For example, the Book of Job. And within 150 Psalms, you have many writers. Those names are not mentioned. Therefore, writers of Old Testament is a vast number. When you come to the intertestamental period, there are more authors involved in this whole process. Therefore, it is the holistic understanding of Bible. You should not confine to only few numbers. Old Testament is written by, inspired by God, and then written by many, compiled. Therefore, Old Testament is a very large volume of God's word. And Jesus' time, yes, Jesus was also quoting prophets, and he was quoting from the scriptures like Kitubim or wisdom literature. Very popular wisdom literature was taken by Jesus Christ. And he's also referring to the Old Testament, the Torah, the Tanakh, the Torah, the Kitubims or the writings, and the Nabi or prophets. So this is the major component of Jesus' Bible. And definitely he was in touch with Torah every time. When he goes to a synagogue, he will open the scriptures and he will read it to them. Therefore, Jesus was more relying on Old Testament, and Old Testament was his Bible. So Bible, New Testament comes to existence only after 70 AD, but till that time Jesus was following some of the oral tradition. And Jesus belongs to a community, I mean Essene community, which is more in research and doing a lot of investigation on scriptures. And it is a separate community which was not under the influence of town and the cities or the civilization. They were freely given time, their time, and they were doing their research work on scriptures. And that's how the Jewish tradition became very strong. Qumran community is one, that major community, ascetic in nature. They were in the wilderness. And then John the Baptist is also one person from that kind of community. That's what Reverend Reuben in the morning session he referred. And sixth question is, when Jacob left to Egypt to join Joseph, 70 of his family accompanied him. Where were a few of the family left behind? The canon. Yes, definitely. There was many people later followed Abraham in migration. So many people came to the people called, a land called Palestine. And there were many other communities also. Edomites were there, and Ammonites were there. So many other communities were there, and the Semitics are part of Abraham's household. So household is not just 70 people or 100 people, maybe many numbers, like their sheep, people who take care of their sheep, cattle, and the workers were also added to their household. Therefore, there are many people followed Abraham from Ur, and then now when they left to Egypt, many were left behind there in Canaan, and many followed. 70 number was given to go to Egypt, and with Joseph family. And the next question is, tax is mentioned in King Saul's time also, enticing David to war in Psalm. The word tera, or in Kannada tera, terige, whereas in English version does not appear. Yes, you have different names for different in different languages. Therefore, tax is mentioned in Bible only when a systematic approach is given by kings to their financial problems or raising resources, funds. Therefore, the temple was not taxing people. In later stages it comes. Early stages it was not. When the question of altar comes, altar was always demanding 1/10 of the giving. Therefore, the 1/10 is the relation between God and the worshipper. So that was very clearly said in the Bible. So 1/10 and the first fruit, these are some of the concepts. And later on, that when temple became the institution, then then it is part of monarchy, the king's administration, then the taxation became so serious. And definitely the taxation is a policy which was not Jewish, and they used to pay tithe, 1/10, and also other offerings. This was there, and it was there in the holy code and holiness code. They have to bring to the altar, not empty hand, they have to bring something. So that was always there, giving was always there. But giving as a tax, as a burden, as extraction, became institutionalized only when the kings became powerful in Israel. That's why God avoided bringing kings to Israel administration, because definitely he knew that these corruptions will come into the people of Israel. It was in other categories of religion, other religions, maybe Palestinians and other Edomites, Amalekites and all these people, they were part of this taxation, or even Babylonians may be part of this taxation. Romans, Greeks, they were part of this taxation. And when they take over the country in a war, and the lootings were also there, and after the defeat, the king has to pay some tribute to the winning king, or he has to give tributes from time to time to these kings. Maybe taxation is also part of this monarchy, and tributes is also part of this monarchy, and looting is also part of this monarchy. Therefore, when Solomon comes, yes, definitely, so Saul time, it emerged. The whole concept of taxation came from the king period, or the king model of administration. Kings definitely need their maintenance. Therefore, that is one part of monarchy, and that is one way of understanding monarchy. Slavery and taxation is part of monarchy, the king administration. As I told earlier in my last session, that Solomon married many queens from outside, not from Israel, many from other places. Even from Egypt he had, from Africa he had women. So like that, they brought different gods to palace, to Jerusalem. And they brought many expensive lifestyle to Jerusalem. So to meet these expenses, Solomon, King Solomon, intensified the taxation. ಸಾಲಮನ್ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ತೆರಿಗೆ ಅಂತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದೇನೆ, ತೆರಿಗೆ ಬಹಳ ವಿಶಾಲವಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಒಂದು ಅರ್ಥದಲ್ಲಿ ಅದನ್ನು ತೆಗೆದುಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದರು. ಅದು ರಾಜರಿಗೂ ಕೊಡಬೇಕಾದಂಥ ತೆರಿಗೆ ಆಗ್ತಾಯಿತ್ತು, ಮತ್ತು ದೇವಾಲಯವನ್ನು ಕಟ್ಟಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಕೊಡಬೇಕಾದಂಥ ತೆರಿಗೆ ಆಗ್ತಾಯಿತ್ತು, ಮತ್ತು ಯುದ್ಧಗಳನ್ನು ನಡೆಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸೈನಿಕರಿಗೆ ಬೇಕಾದಂಥ ಆಹಾರ ಮತ್ತು ಅವರಿಗೆ ಬೇಕಾದಂಥ ಎಲ್ಲ ಅವಶ್ಯಕತೆಗಳನ್ನು ಪೂರೈಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಬೇಕಾಗ್ತಾಯಿತ್ತು. ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ಯುದ್ಧದ ಖರ್ಚುಗಳು ಇದ್ದರೆ, ಮತ್ತೊಂದು ಕಡೆ ದೇವಾಲಯವನ್ನು ಕಟ್ಟುವಂಥದ್ದು ಮತ್ತು ರಾಜರ ಪ್ರತಿ ದಿವಸದ ಆ ಒಂದು ಅರಮನೆಯ ಖರ್ಚುಗಳೇನಿತ್ತು ಅದನ್ನು ನಿಭಾಯಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಈ ಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಸ್ ಅಥವಾ ತೆರಿಗೆಯನ್ನು ಕಡ್ಡಾಯವಾಗಿ ಕೊಡಬೇಕಾಗಿತ್ತು. ಅದರಿಂದ ಒಂದು ಅದು ಒಂದು ಅನಿವಾರ್ಯತೆ ಆಯಿತು. ಅನಿವಾರ್ಯತೆ ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಸು ಬಹಳ ಸೂಕ್ಷ್ಮವಾದ ವಿಚಾರ ಆಗಲಿಲ್ಲ, ದೇವರಿಗೂ ಸಂಬಂಧಪಡ್ತಾ ಇರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಪ್ರಾಪಂಚಿಕವಾದಂಥ ವಿಚಾರಗಳಿಗಾಗಿ ಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಸನ್ನು ಕೊಡಬೇಕಾಯಿತು. ದೇವರಿಗೆ ಕೊಡುವಂಥದ್ದು ದಶಮಾಂಶ ಭಾಗ ಮತ್ತು ದೇವರಿಗೆ ಕೊಡಬೇಕಂದು ಸ್ಯಾಕ್ರಿಫೈಸಸ್ ಅಥವಾ ಅರ್ಪಣೆ ಅದೆಲ್ಲ ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ಇತ್ತು. ಆದ ಕಾರಣ ಯೇಸು ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ಈ ವಿಚಾರದಲ್ಲಿ ಬಹಳ ಬಹಳ ವಿಮರ್ಶಾತ್ಮಕವಾಗಿ ಮಾತನಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಒಬ್ಬ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿ ಆಗ್ತಾನೆ. ವಿಧವೆ ಕೊಡುವಂಥ ದುಗಣಿ ಕಾಸೇನಿದೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ನೋಡ್ತಾನೆ. ದೇವರಿಗೆ ಕೊಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು, ದೇವರಿಗೆ ಕೊಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದನ್ನು ಮತ್ತು ಸೀಸರನಿಗೆ ಕೊಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಇದು ಇದರ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಸ್ಗಳನ್ನು ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾನೆ. ಆತನೂ ಸಹ ಆ ಒಂದು ಅನಿವಾರ್ಯತೆಗೆ ಆತನ ಒಳಗಾಗಿರ್ತಾನೆ ಕೊಡೋದರಲ್ಲಿ, ಅದನ್ನು ಕೊಡೋದರಲ್ಲಿ ಅನಿವಾರ್ಯ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಸ್ ಅನ್ನೋದೇನಿದೆ, ಇದು ಸೌಲನ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಅದೇ ಕಿಂಗ್ಶಿಪ್ ಬರುವ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಮೊನಾರ್ಕಿ ಅಥವಾ ರಾಜರ ಆಡಳಿತ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭದಲ್ಲಿಯೇ ಈ ಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಸನ್ನು ನಾವು ಕಾಣ್ತಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಇವರು ಕೇಳಿರುವಂಥ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಇದು ಸರಿಯಾದಂಥ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಶಿಬಾ ವಿಮಲಾ ಬಾಯ್ ಇವರು ಕೇಳಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು, ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ವಾಸ್ ದ ಒರಿಜಿನಲ್ ರೈಟರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮ್ಯಾಥ್ಯೂ ಆನ್ ದ ಲೂಕ್ ವರ್ ವಾಸ್ ರಿಟನ್ ವಿತ್ ಓರಲ್ ಟ್ರೆಡಿಷನ್ ಟೇಕನ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಮಾರ್ಕ್. ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದೆಮ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲ್? ಇದನ್ನು ನಾವು ಮುಂದಿನ ಸೆಷನ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ನೋಡ್ತೇವೆ. ಆದರೂ ಸಹ ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಬಹಳ ಸಂಕ್ಷಿಪ್ತವಾಗಿ ಬಹಳ ಪ್ರಿಸೈಸ್ ಆಗಿ ಬರೆಯುವಂಥ ಒಬ್ಬ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲ್ ರೈಟರ್. ಮತ್ತು ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾರ್ಕನ ಸುವಾರ್ತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ನೋಡೋದೇನೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ಯೇಸು ಸ್ವಾಮಿಯ ಜನನದ ಚರಿತ್ರೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ಮತ್ತು ಅನೇಕ ವಿಚಾರಗಳು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಬರೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಆದರೆ ಮಾರ್ಕನು ಅನ್ಯರಿಗೆ ಬರೆಯುವಾಗ ಮತ್ತು ಅದರ ತುರ್ತು ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಆತನು ಬರೆಯುವಾಗ ಭಾಳ ಸ್ಪಷ್ಟವಾಗಿ ಈ ವಿಚಾರಗಳನ್ನು ಆತನು ಬರಿತಾ ಹೋಗ್ತಾನೆ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಈ ಎಲ್ಲ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲ್ಗಳು ಇತರರಿಗಾಗಿ ಬರೆದಿರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಅವರಲ್ಲಿ ತಮ್ಮದೇ ಆದಂಥ ಕೆಲವು ಒಂದು ವಿಶೇಷತೆಗಳನ್ನು ನಾವು ಈ ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಇದು ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಮತ್ತು ಲೂಕ್ ಮತ್ತು ಈ ಮೂರರಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಕಾಣ್ತೇವೆ. ಫೋರ್ತ್ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲ್ ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಅದನ್ನು ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಆಗಿ ಫೋರ್ತ್ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲನ್ನು ನಾವು ಯೋಹಾನನ ಸುವಾರ್ತೆಯನ್ನು ನಾವು ಕರಿತೇವೆ. ಯಾಕೆಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಯೋಹಾನನ ಸುವಾರ್ತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇಹಪರ ಅಂದರೆ ಇಮ್ಮನೆಂಟ್ ಈ ಇಹಲೋಕದ ಜೀವಿತ ಮತ್ತು ಪರಲೋಕದ ಜೀವಿತದ ಹೆಚ್ಚಾದಂಥ ವಿಚಾರಗಳನ್ನು ಬಹಳ ತಾತ್ವಿಕತೆಯಿಂದ ಬರೆದಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಅಥವಾ ಗ್ರೀಕ್ ಇನ್ಫ್ಲುಯೆನ್ಸ್ ಇರತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಗ್ರೀಕ್ ಫಿಲಾಸಫಿ ಏನಿದೆ ಆ ಗ್ರೀಕ್ ಜನರಿಗೆ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಮತ್ತು ಪ್ರಪಂಚದ ಹೊರಪ್ರಪಂಚಕ್ಕೆ ಅದು ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಎನ್ನುವಂಥ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಗ್ರೀಕ್ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿಯ ವಿಚಾರ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿದ್ವಿ. ಅದು ಹರಡಿದಂಥ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಅದು ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಹೋಗಿತ್ತಾಗಲೇ, ಆದ ಕಾರಣ ಅದನ್ನು ಅವರು ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದರು. ಹೀಗಾಗಿ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲ್ ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಏನಿದೆ ಇದು ಎಲ್ಲರ ಮೇಲೆ ಅಂದರೆ ಹೊಸ ಒಡಂಬಡಿಕೆಯ ಬರಹಗಾರರೇನಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಇನ್ಕ್ಲೂಡಿಂಗ್ ಯೋಹಾನ ಮತ್ತು ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಯೋಹಾನ ಪೌಲ ಮತ್ತು ಇತರ ರೈಟರ್ಸ್ ಏನಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಪೇತ್ರ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಇನ್ಯಾರು ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಇವರ ಎಲ್ಲರ ಬರವಣಿಗೆಗಳ ಮೇಲೆ ಮಾರ್ಕನ ಒಂದು ಮುದ್ರೆ ಇದೆ. ಮಾರ್ಕನು ಬರೆದಂಥ ಈ ಸುವಾರ್ತೆಯ ವಿಶೇಷತೆಯನ್ನು ನಾವು ಈ ಎಲ್ಲ ರೈಟಿಂಗ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸಿ ದ ಇನ್ಫ್ಲುಯೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸೇಂಟ್ ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲ್ ಆನ್ ಅದರ್ ರೈಟಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇನ್ ದ ನ್ಯೂ ಟೆಸ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್. ದೇರ್ ಫೋರ್ ಸೇಂಟ್ ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ಸ್ ಎ ಸೀಡ್ ಲೈಕ್ ನೋ ದ ಅರ್ಲಿಯೆಸ್ಟ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಜೆನಿಸಿಸ್ ದ ಬುಕ್ ಆಫ್ ಜೆನಿಸಿಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ಸ್ ಎ ಸೀಡ್ ಬುಕ್ ಫಾರ್ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲ್. ಅವುಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಬರುವಂಥ ಎಲ್ಲ ಘಟನೆಗಳು ಬಹಳ ಅರ್ಥಗರ್ಭಿತವಾಗಿ ಬಹಳ ಪ್ರಿಸೈಸ್ ಆಗಿ ಬಹಳ ಸುಂದರವಾಗಿ ಬರೆಯಲ್ಪಟ್ಟಂಥ ಗಾಸ್ಪಲ್ ಆಗಿರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಇದನ್ನು ಒರಿಜಿನಲ್ ಆಗಿ ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ತೆಗೆದುಕೊಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಮತ್ತು ಸತ್ಯವೇದ ಅಧ್ಯಯನ ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥವರು ಸಹ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ತನ್ನದೇ ಆದಂಥ ಈ ಮಾರ್ಕನ ಸುವಾರ್ತೆಯ ದೃಷ್ಟಿಕೋನವನ್ನು ಅವರ ಅಧ್ಯಯನಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಇಟ್ಟುಕೊಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಮತ್ತಾಯನ್ ಪ್ರಯಾರಿಟಿ ಅಂತ ಕರೀತಾರೆ, ಲೂಕನ್ ಮಾರ್ಕನ್ ಪ್ರಯಾರಿಟಿಗಳಂತ ಕರೀತಾರೆ. ತಮ್ಮದೇ ಆದಂಥ ವಿಶೇಷತೆಯನ್ನು ಸೂಚಿಸುವಂಥ ಮಾರ್ಕನ ಸುವಾರ್ತೆಯನ್ನು ಎಲ್ಲ ತತ್ವಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಮತ್ತು ಧರ್ಮಗ್ರಂಥನ ಓದುವಂಥವ್ರು ಅಧ್ಯಯನ ಮಾಡುವಂಥವ್ರು ಅದನ್ನು ಗಮನಿಸ್ತಾರೆ. ಆದ ಕಾರಣ ಈ ಕ್ವಶನ್ಗಳು ಭಾಳ ವಿಶೇಷವಾದಂಥದ್ದು. ಎಲ್ಲವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಮತ್ತೆ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಸೆಷನ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಅದನ್ನು ನಾವು ಮತ್ತೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಮತ್ತೆ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ತೇವೆ. ನಾನು ಕೆಲವು ನಿಮಿಷಗಳ ಕಾಲ ದ ಬುಕ್ ಆಫ್ ಜೆನೆಸಿಸ್ ಅಥವಾ ಆದಿಕಾಂಡ ಪುಸ್ತಕವನ್ನು ಭಾಳ ಸಂಕ್ಷಿಪ್ತವಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಹೇಳಿ ಮುಗಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಇಷ್ಟಪಡುತ್ತೇನೆ. ಆದಿಕಾಂಡ ಪುಸ್ತಕ ಇದು ವಿಶೇಷವಾಗಿ ಸತ್ಯವೇದದ ಎಲ್ಲ ಡಾಕ್ಟ್ರಿನ್ಗಳನ್ನು ಅಥವಾ ಎಲ್ಲ ವಿಧವಾದಂಥ ಸೂಕ್ಷ್ಮತೆಗಳನ್ನು ಹೊಂದಿದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಪುಸ್ತಕ ಇದಾಗಿರುತ್ತದೆ. ಈ ಪುಸ್ತಕದ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭದ ಮತ್ತು ಕೊನೆಯ ಅಧ್ಯಾಯಗಳನ್ನು ನೀವು ನೋಡುವಾಗ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ಅದು ಕ್ರಿಯೇಷನ್ ಅಥವಾ ಪ್ರೀ ಹಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ, ಇಟ್ ಗೋಸ್ ವಿತ್ ಪ್ರೀ ಹಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ. ಪ್ರೀ ಹಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಗಾಡ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟೆಡ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಬೀಯಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಪ್ರೀ ಹಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟೆಡ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಟು ಥರ್ಡ್ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪ್ರೀ ಹಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ ಸ್ಟೋರಿ, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಿತಿನ್ ದಟ್ ಮ್ಯಾನ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇಸ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟೆಡ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಷನ್, ಫಾಲ್, ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಟೇಕ್ಸ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್ ವಿತಿನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಶಾರ್ಟ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದೀಸ್ ತ್ರೀ ಪ್ಯಾಸೇಜಸ್, ತ್ರೀ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದ ರೈಸ್ ಆಫ್ ನೇಷನ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ 11 ಆನ್ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್. ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ರೈಸ್ ಆಫ್ ನೇಷನ್. ರೈಸ್ ಆಫ್ ನೇಷನ್ ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್. ಚಾಯ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮ್, ಹೌ ಹಿ ಮೂವ್ಡ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಊರ್ ಟು ದ ಪ್ಯಾಲೆಸ್ಟೈನ್, ದ ಪ್ರಾಮಿಸ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಕವರ್ನೆಂಟ್ ವಿತ್ ಹಿಮ್. ಕವರ್ನೆಂಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಟು ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ದ ನೇಷನ್ಸ್, ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ದ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಆನ್ ದ ಅರ್ತ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಜಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಸ್ಟೋರಿ, ಸೊಡೊಮ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಗೊಮೊರ್, ದ ಜಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಸ್ಟೋರಿ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಸ್ಟೋರೀಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಾರಾ, ಐಸಾಕ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅದರ್ ಇಸ್ಮಾಯಿಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅದರ್ ಸ್ಟೋರೀಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಚಾಯ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಐಸಾಕ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಚಾಯ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಜೇಕಬ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಚಾಯ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಜೋಸೆಫ್, ಜೂಡಾ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅದರ್ ಸ್ಟೋರೀಸ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಸ್ಟೋರೀಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮ್. ದ ಅಬ್ರಹಾಮ್ ದ ಫಾದರ್ ಆಫ್ ಫೇತ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಫಾದರ್ ಆಫ್ ನೇಷನ್, ಫಾದರ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಲ್ ಬಿಲೀವರ್ಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಥರ್ಶಿಪ್, ಆರಿಜಿನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಥರ್ಶಿಪ್. ಮೋಸಸ್ ಸಪೋಸ್ ಟು ಬಿ ದ ರೈಟರ್ ಆಫ್ ಜೆನಿಸಿಸ್. ಮೋಸಸ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ರೈಟರ್ ಆಫ್ ಜೆನಿಸಿಸ್. ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ರೆಫರ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ಎಕ್ಸಲೆಸ್ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ 24:4, ಡ್ಯೂಟ್ರಾನಮಿ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ 31:9. ವೆರಿ ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ಲಿ ಇಂಡಿಕೇಟ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಮೋಸಸ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಆಥರ್. ಸೊ ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ಗ್ರೌಂಡ್ ಫಾರ್ ಮೋಸಸ್ ಟು ಬಿ ದ ಆಥರ್ ಆಫ್ ಜೆನಿಸಿಸ್. ಮೋಶೆ ಆದಿಕಾಂಡ ಪುಸ್ತಕದ ಒಬ್ಬ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾದಂಥ ಬರಹಗಾರ ಅನ್ನೋದರಲ್ಲಿ ಅನೇಕ ಅಂಶಗಳನ್ನು ನಾವು ಕಾಣ್ತೇವೆ. ಏನದು? ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಎನ್ ಆರ್ಡಿನರಿ ಜೂ, ಆರ್ಡಿನರಿ ಇಸ್ರೇಲೈಟ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಟೈಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಎಕ್ಸಡಸ್. ಆತನು ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯನಾದಂಥ ಒಬ್ಬ ಮನುಷ್ಯನಾಗಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಬದಲಾಗಿ ಅವನು ರಾಜರ ವಂಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಬೆಳೆದಂಥ ಒಬ್ಬ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿ. ಅವನು ಇಸ್ರೇಲ್ ಕುಲಕ್ಕೆ ಸೇರಿದವನಾದರೂ ಅವನು ಬೆಳೆದಂಥದ್ದು ಅದು ಅರಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಮತ್ತು ರಾಜರ ಸಮ್ಮುಖದಲ್ಲಿ ಅಂತ ಕೇಳ್ತೇವೆ. ಆದ ಕಾರಣ ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಅ ವೆಲ್ ಎಜುಕೇಟೆಡ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್. ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಎಜುಕೇಟೆಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹಿ ನ್ಯೂ ದ ಟೆಕ್ನಾಲಜಿ ಆಫ್ ಪೇಪರ್ ದೋಸ್ ಡೇಸ್. ಪ್ಯಾಪರಸ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಇನ್ ಈಜಿಪ್ಟ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇಫ್ ಯು ರೀಡ್ ಸಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಸ್ಕಾಲ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಾಲ್ ರೈಟಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಕೊನಾರ್ಕ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅದರ್ ಟೆಂಪಲ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಈಜಿಪ್ಟ್, ವೇರ್ ಯು ಫೈಂಡ್ ಎ ವೆರಿ ಕ್ಲೋಸ್ ರಿಲೇಷನ್ಶಿಪ್ ಟು ದ ಸ್ಟೋರೀಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಫೋರ್ ಬುಕ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಬೈಬಲ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇರ್ ಫೋರ್ ಈತನು ಬಹಳ ಶಿಕ್ಷಿತನಾಗಿದೆ. ಈಸ್ ಅ ವೆಲ್ ಎಜುಕೇಟೆಡ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಪ್ರೊಫೌಂಡ್ ಇನ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್. ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಪ್ರೊಫೌಂಡ್ ಇನ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್ ಇನ್ ಸ್ಕ್ರಿಪ್ಚರ್ಸ್, ಮೇ ಬಿ ದ ಹಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ, ರಿಲಿಜಿಯನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಕಲ್ಚರ್ ಆಫ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಬೋತ್ ಇಸ್ರೇಲ್ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ದ ಈಜಿಪ್ಷಿಯನ್ಸ್. ದೇರ್ ಫೋರ್ ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಏಬಲ್ ಟು ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಕೇಟ್ ವಿತ್ ಗಾಡ್ ವೆರಿ ಫ್ರೀಕ್ವೆಂಟ್ಲಿ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇಸ್ ಮ್ಯಾನ್ ಆಫ್ ಗಾಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹಿ ಪ್ರಿಸರ್ವ್ಡ್ ದ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡ್ಸ್. ಮೇ ಬಿ ಈಜಿಪ್ಷಿಯನ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ನೋನ್ ಫಾರ್ ಪ್ರಿಸರ್ವಿಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ಈವನ್ ದ ಡೆಡ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ದೇ ಪ್ರಿಸರ್ವ್. ಇನ್ ದಟ್ ಕೇಸ್ ದೇ ಪ್ರಿಸರ್ವ್ ದ ವ್ಯಾಲ್ಯೂಬಲ್ ರೈಟಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ವ್ಯಾಲ್ಯೂಬಲ್ ಆರ್ಟ್, ಆರ್ಟಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇರ್ ಕಲ್ಚರ್. their paintings, everything they try to preserve. Therefore, the Egyptians are known for preserving the documents. And here, Moses is the one who preserved this, whatever God spoke to him or gave to him. He accepted the oral tradition. He accepted the history. He accepted God's revelation also. He was an author, a very clear author, and also an editor. He was also an editor, good editor and compiler. He was also a compiler, and also he kept the records. He preserved the records. Therefore, God gave him all these tablets also, the Ten Commandments, the oral, the written one, everything God gives. And also, he was the one who preserved the Ark of God, where he has to carry from time to time. That was his responsibility. Overall responsibility of Moses was to take people and the Ark and God's tradition, God's words from generation to generation. Therefore, his role is not just releasing people from Egypt. He has so many other duties, so many responsibilities. He's a prophet, he's a judge, and he's a preserver of records, he's a writer, so many things he had. And then that's why God gives this greatest responsibility to form a nation and to form God's word according to the scriptures, whatever God thought. And therefore, he writes the creation story, and that he calls received by God. If you read Exodus chapter 33:1, you find the references to that, and also Deuteronomy 34 verse 10. And therefore, the discernment as well as the orally transmitted from generation to generation was one of the traditions of Israel. Therefore, the tradition of Pascha was taken from one generation to another generation because of the oral tradition. And the people of Israel are very religious, and they practice their religion. They don't just read it and then close it and come to the church or synagogue next week. No, every day they meditate on that. Every day they recite the verses. Therefore, the oral tradition was very strong. Very strong. And the beauty of Israeli scholarship is always oral and written traditions. Therefore, Moses was the author of Genesis, the revelation from God. And if you read Exodus chapter 6 onwards, there the tone changes. The God becomes Almighty God, and therefore that also a reference point. And if you say the non-Mosaic, I referred the non-Mosaic sources of the Pentateuch, JEDP, Jehovah tradition, Elohim tradition, Deuteronomic tradition, and the priestly tradition. I don't want to go in detail, and that is already there, and that is also part of understanding Genesis story, and also Genesis chronologically, Genesis events. And Genesis and creation. This is very, the first three or four chapters of Genesis, it talks about creation. Now, what is creation? Creation has two dimensions. Well, the first creation is material world, creation of life and other things. And the second part of creation is the spiritual beings, spiritual world, spiritual things. Therefore, the spiritual and material begins with the same chapters. For example, if you read the story of Lucifer and human beings, and also Garden of Eden, these two are together, or three together. One is creation, that is Adam and Eve, the human creation, and the creation of the birds of the nature, and then other material, light, life, and other creation, material creation, and also God's creation of the heavenly beings. And that's where the fall takes place. Therefore, the early chapters, 1 to 10 chapters of Genesis, is full of these original stories. Original sin comes, disobedience to God, and fall of the angels. Lucifer was thrown out from the heaven, Isaiah 14 talks about that. So like that, the stories are original in nature, origin, the beginning of all this story comes in, and redemption also follows. The redemption, the salvation also is part of this creation story, pre-creation story. And Abraham becomes the hero of the salvation story. And if you look into the creation, little bit I want to stress on this creation. Creation has two dimensions, I told earlier. The first one is he created, 6 days he created heaven and earth, and the Holy Spirit, the Spirit was brooding on the waters, and God created day and night, dry land, life, life in water, life on earth, and vegetation and animal world, everything, and also human beings. And he separated everything from chaotic condition. He separated things. He separated land from water, and then day, night, and he separated vegetation, the world, vegetation, the world, green world, and human beings, life, everything he separated, and he told Adam to name it also. So the knowledge begins from there. And then this we normally we speak in our church sermons and other studies, whereas the other creation of God is also referred to, the creation of the angels, creation of angels, the spiritual world. And there you have many categories of angels he created. For example, cherubims were there, seraphims were there, and these cherubims are very powerful God's angels, guarding the holiness and the eternal worship center of God. And similarly, you have the tabernacle. It is in heaven. It is controlled by seraphims and other angels. And you have angels like Gabriel like angels, and also Michael. Gabriel is also a communicating, a messenger angel. And then Michael is also a warrior angel. So these are some of the forces created by God in the heavenly creation. And this is also there in the whole thing. And now these angels are created, yes, in creation. This is also part, and we normally forget the role of these heavenly beings created by God, and then that we have to take very seriously, because our spiritual experiences begins from this kind of created beings, heavenly beings by God. And the work of angels, I mean, this is throughout the Bible. You cannot avoid angels. Story of angels definitely is part of our faith, our journey, our faith journey, our reading of the Bible. Therefore, the angel, the stories of angel, the duties of angel teach so many things to our spiritual life. For example, it is eternally praising God and His greatness. That we can see that in Psalms 103. 20 verse 20, Isaiah 6, and Revelation chapter 5, 11. And they serve the people who have inherited the salvation. The New Testament reading, Hebrew chapter 1, 14 verse. They serve. God has appointed heavenly beings, angels, to serve human beings who are after salvation, who have taken salvation, who have experienced salvation. Therefore, it is there to serve the people. And then their duty is to rejoice at the conversion of a sinner. Luke talks about that, chapter 15, verse 10. The angels are also rejoice when a person becomes the part of kingdom of God. And watch over believers. And we don't believe also. We have more liberal ideas on these things, spiritual things, but whereas Bible talks about this, they are part of our creation. They are part of how we created, they were also created. Therefore, there is a mutual support between the spiritual world created and the material world, the human life and things created. Therefore, they watch over us, definitely. If a man is given freedom, he will go everywhere and then he has no guards. Therefore, in the New Testament also, the work of the Holy Spirit comes as a comforter, as a supporter, as an encouraging element in the whole mission of God. So therefore, it is watch over believers. And the New Old Testament, it is full of such stories. Therefore, we cannot avoid the faith story through angels. Even Jesus' birth also is part of that. And protect the little ones. It's a wonderful experience, you know. Even the small children were also protected by the holy angels. And this is what Matthew says. Jesus only speaks all these things. Matthew chapter 18 verse 10. And they're all there in the church. Their presence is there in the church. 1 Corinthians, please refer this. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 10. They are present in the assembly. They are present wherever people worship God. And wherever there is a fellowship, there is the presence of the angels. God also present with the angels. And this is the wonderful experience of being part of this heavenly creation. And they will communicate, the angels will communicate, the convey as believers to, it connects to Abraham. This is what Luke chapter 16 verse 22, it says that Abraham is connected by angels. That is the duty of the angels. And you are supposed to be part of this wonderful comforters. And also bear special revelation. It also brings special revelation from God. Daniel, book of Daniel, you see that whole thing. And also Zechariah chapter 1, verse 12 to 14, you have this. And communicate believers. Communicate believers with the blessing. Blessing also is communicated through angels. And execute God's judgment. This is the final duty of the angels. Execute judgment on his enemies. And this is the way the book of Genesis is wonderful. We need to undergo a rigorous training on understanding what is the whole understanding of this thing. And then you have fallen angels. I told earlier, created God by God, and they follow Lucifer because of their arrogance, because of their disobedience, because of their rebelling nature in heavens. God sent them out of that. And the whole question of time in the book of Genesis is very important. Therefore, it is the original creation. This, the theme is that it was created in 6 days time. So there are two kinds of argument. One argument is there was a chaotic condition according to Genesis chapter 1. It says that the spirit was brooding over. It was there. And everything was in chaotic condition. That means the creation mentioned in the Bible, in the Genesis, also the prehistory, there was already some chaotic creation was there, and some creation was there, and there was no order, there was no separation. Water and earth, everything was mixed up, and therefore the separation comes, or the creation comes from the pre-existed materials, the early materials. Therefore, the word in the beginning is very important. The word beginning, adiyalli is very important. Adiyile, in Tamil it is Adiyile. Adiyalli, in Adi, the beginning, it has no limitation of time. We don't know what kind of materials were there. Even the new discoveries also says that the moon and other planets were also. We don't know what kind of material already there. But God created, and there are some arguments that God created material from existing material, and he made it very clear to the new creation, and he brought material to suit to the world he created. And therefore, the pre-existing material he takes, and then he makes it, as a big craftsman, he creates a new creation. Maybe that may be the understanding. But definitely, there was in existence, and God is a creator who can create new things also. But the Genesis first verses says that there was chaos and there was darkness, there was no light, and there was darkness, there was water, everything mixed, chaotic conditions. But God separated everything, and he took each day for separating these things, and he named it, and then he dominated it, and then he gave it to human beings. Therefore, the word yom in Hebrew, it's an ordinary day. 24 hours, like, is an ordinary day. And this beginning, the word beginning, adi, it has a vast kind of, you know, time. There is no time limit for that. It is eternal. Time is eternal. And further, if you read the gospel, I mean the New Testament, Old Testament, and then you have the theological understanding of Old Testament. For example, flood is one issue where destruction comes, the Noah, the final destruction of God, intended to finish the human, and he regrets for creating human beings at that time. And flood has no archaeological evidences, but there was one scholar who made some research on that, Sir Leonard Woolley. He refers the silt deposited near Euphrates and Tigris, that is in Babylonia, and he says maybe the silt deposited in that region is because of the flood, and there was heavy rains in that place, and therefore the flood was a reality there. And according to his research, he says that it was according to the flood which came there very very brutally came and then destroyed the people, and the silt also deposited very in volume. Therefore, he refers that. And the patriarchal narrations, for example, 2000 to 1500 BC, that is up to Exodus. After Exodus, you don't see much reference to patriarchal Abraham and other people, but the new generation, Israel, refers Abraham as their faith father of faith. And a patriarchal call by God, and also the nations, nations, story of nations begins, and the tribes become very strong in the context of occupation of the land. And Genesis and theology. Now, what is theology of Genesis? It has original events recorded very clearly, and particularly the evolution of man. Evolution of man. See, still anthropologists and also archaeologists are not clear about saying what is really the issue. It is more a theological issue for us to believe that God created human beings in his own image, definitely. At the same time, the stories also indicate that salvation of human beings, human being is definitely a greater creation of God, or a special creation of God, where he has a totally different spiritual behavior, or even emotional behavior compared to animal world. Maybe that may be the reason why human beings cannot be compared to ape. Whether man came from ape or ape came from man, that is going to be a dialogue, and then between this. But the significance still lies on these two separations, evolution and man's evolution, and also creation story, which is God's image. Therefore, there is the maybe contradiction between biblical and theological perspective of the Bible writers and the Bible believers, and scientifically evolution theory, and then evolutionist perspective. But whatever it is, Genesis clearly speaks about human source. What is the source? God is the source. God is the source, and we come from God. Definitely, this is a belief we have in this book. And therefore, it is always the Genesis narrations lack evidence, but from time to time, evidence also are collected through archaeology and through other medias. And therefore, one day those things will be proved. We don't know when, but definitely there is always time for us to understand these things. And therefore, the theological significance may be still discerned, and this whole biblical narrations and biblical quotations and also the story events and references definitely will open up the research, open up for research. And therefore, we make it more biblical and theological, but these theological and biblical significance cannot be ruled out. I mean, you cannot rule out the Genesis story, you cannot rule out the history of man and the creation of man, fall of all these problems, and also Abraham and other stories in the Bible, Exodus and other stories. Definitely, this will come to some perfection in human excavations and also human discoveries in the coming future. Therefore, with this small introduction, I would like to conclude this session. Thank you for listening to the presentations, and I also pray that you continue to be safe, continue to be safe under God's protection. And it looks that, you know, we cannot go for one more. Maybe it is inevitable that we need to meet personally, but whatever it is, the second Saturday of July, definitely we will meet either on online or in particularly in some places where more place is there and more distancing can be maintained and things like that. We can think about this. And if there is a restriction, there is a social isolation needed from here afterwards, definitely we will go for online. Thank you very much. Let us pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank and praise Thee for this wonderful time of reflection and reading and study. At this hour of prayer, Lord, we thank You for all the presentations and also God's Word and technical and other help You have provided to study Your Word and also study the skills of ministry. At this hour of prayer, Lord, we commit all the FMA participants into Your mighty hand. Help them, make them to understand the God's word under their own context and with their own discernment and with their own exercise and efforts. At this hour of Lord, we commit their families, their ministry, their work and their endeavors into Your mighty hand. Help and make them to be shining witnesses in their own church and communities. Lord, once again, we remember the victims of all the disease and other problems. And we also pray that Your guiding hand and Your exodus will really make them free from all these bondages. Once again, Lord, we commit this time and our effort and our future, all plans into Your mighty hand. Help us and bless us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our trespasses as we forgive those trespasses against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God and fellowship of Holy Spirit, rest and abide with us now and forevermore.